these events can only be succeed, guys. I know there's people there sitting waiting for the shit to get put up on YouTube, the wee shit, but there's stuff to get put on YouTube. However, it's only bums and seats. This isn't free. This costs money because we've got to give the woman downstairs some money for the use of the room. We've got to cover the expenses of the guys who are here. That can only be covered by people's bums and seats. So we do encourage people to watch our stuff on YouTube. If you can find a way to get some money to these guys to support what they're doing, and also big one is advertise. It gets tiresome, if it's the preaching to the converted every week, it gets tiresome, you know. So bringing new faces in, because promise you, if the guys who are brand new to this, we will blow your mind with information. We will blow everything you believe will tear apart and rebuild what you think and the world works. And we're only doing that by everybody contributing to it, you know. So if you're new, don't sit in the background, get involved. Use this Wednesday night and then the Sunday as a method by which you can do a bit of networking, get to meet people, learn from people, ask questions. Always ask questions. Never ask too many questions. Nobody gets tired of you asking questions. So if you're brand new to this, feel free. Don't feel stupid, because the ones out there, right, the ones that are voting, the ones that think the government's going to save the day for them, are the ones not asking questions, right? The guy who always came top of the class was the guy who asked a lot of questions. You know, don't be ashamed to ask questions. Don't be ashamed to say, I don't know. The greatest thing I can hear somebody tell me is, I don't know, or I've just changed my mind in something. So it's all about, you know, learning, but we need you to advertise and to bring new people on board. I'm bringing speakers in here who are fairly mainstream and their views. There's some wackies out there, but we're bringing the fairly mainstream. So this is, you can bring, you know, Joe Serene blogs to these meetings. They will learn stuff. They'll go away having learned something. What they choose to do with that is up to them. We don't force anyone. We don't force views upon anyone. It's up to you to do with what you want with the information that's given to you. All we do ask is that people do start thinking for themselves. If by doing these I can convince somebody who doesn't read to pick up a book or to make a phone call or to go and visit a website or to ask a question or go and check a fact, that's my work's done here, sort of thing. Anyway, on that happy note, I'll pass over to Peter. Now Peter's come here at great expense himself, and this is some strange things happened recently, so it was a bit touch and go whether he'd make it today. So I'd just like to thank Peter for
thank you for the excellent introduction. For those who haven't heard really what the initiative or the thrust is within this movement for change, you'll just have to maybe, you know, like Morpheus says in the Matrix, your mind will have to sort of adjust and sort of make it real and fill in a little bit. So I'm actually going to talk on the basis that people know what's been happening or what I'm about, and then from that point there we'll explore some of the issues that have happened over the last 48 hours in particular. I'd also then like to, if somebody can remind me, just to touch on Michael of Benicia's work, because some of you were maybe, was it last Friday? No, not this Friday, just gone, the Friday before, at Nottingham, at the family courts, where Tom Crawford's case was heard. So please prompt me, and I'll give you my views on what I think are the failings of what happened there, why it'll fail again, and why it's possibly the wrong avenue to be chasing the rabbit down. So before we get started and move on to, should we say, the nuts and bolts, as was alluded to at the introduction, I nearly sort of changed my mind in coming today. And that's the reason is that the website, wearebank.co.uk, has been taken down off the internet. And also the PayPal accounts have been frozen. And also I went to try and make a purchase yesterday with my bank account, and that's been frozen. So actually it says it doesn't exist anymore when I go onto the online banking. So I found it very unusual that, you know, a high street bank can take a unilateral action like that, not give me any warning, no email, nothing, it's just, it's not there anymore. It says you no longer have accounts, some words to that effect. So how this all started is, for people who don't know what we're about, there is a phenomenon that I describe myself as what I do, something called Peter of England. And this was a declaration in 2012, principally, that I was making a statement to the state, which is a very difficult entity to nail down or pin down. In effect, it doesn't exist anywhere except in your mind. However, it is peopled by politicians. It's peopled by the sort of, should we say, the three main pillars of what's called our constitutional arrangement. That's the judiciary, the legislature, and the executive. Now, these three bodies are supposed to be independent. They're supposed to be like watertight compartments on a ship. And there should be communication between them, but their integrity should be maintained at all costs. Now, I would suggest, therefore, that if any of those watertight compartments have been ruptured, then there's been a leakage into one of the others, and therefore the whole mechanism can't be trusted. And we can see that that is the case, because whereby in, should we say, the 60s and 70s in the court of law, when you had people quite well respected both in the judiciary and outside, like Lord Denning, who was the then Master of the Rolls, they would actually make law and alter the laws from the benches that they were sitting on in the court. So if something looked unfair, they would use their principles of common law, their common sense, and they would actually say, well, no, we think this is what the interpretation should be. But now what we're in is an Orwellian, tyrannical, tiptoe, Orwellian state, whereby all these statutory laws have crept in onto the agenda, and now we can't move, we can't breathe, we can't park a car, we can't live in our homes, we can't do what we want with our children without there being a statute or some type of local council authority or a mandate saying, if you don't do this, then the following has got to happen. So there comes a point when the individual has a moral, legal, social, and ethical right and duty to rebel against that oppression. The problem is that we are probably 50 years behind the move point or the tip point. So the things that our forefathers should have done, possibly your grandparents, but let's say at least your parents, these actions that should have been taken then are now way, way overdue. And, you know, the cake that should have come out of the oven is still in the oven, and it's you know, it's well overcooked. Now, what's been drawn over people's eyes over the last 20 years in particular, is this blind subservience to the jobs worth, whether it's the parking warden, whether it's the police officer, whether it's the council worker, whether it's someone from social services, whether it's in a hospital. The whole society is infected with this mindset which says, well, this is the way it has to be. And many of you will, you know, hear this statement about, it was about people who were called Jobsworths. I think it was quite popular expression in the late 80s or mid 90s. When, you know, I can't change it, mate, it's more than a job's worth. And so it never got changed, and it doesn't get budged. And so what's happened is there's this toxic or corrosive element that's crept into society now, which is society. And there doesn't seem to be too much we can do about it, because we are surveyed, whether our cars, like coming down here today on the motorway, if you don't adhere to the 50 mile an hour average speed check limit, then you're going to end up with probably a £40 to £80 fine. And if you do it too often, you're going to end up with excessive points on the license, no license, and your ability to earn a living taken away from you. So the fundamental questions in all of this are, why? Why are they doing it? What's the point? I mean, you know, if we all got together here as a fairly socially homogenous group, I wouldn't actually try to be doing these things on you, because I, try and have, like, you know, a laissez-faire attitude of let sleeping dogs lie. If it's not broke, you know, don't fix it. So let's just get on with our lives. But that's obviously not what's happening.
The power to exercise discretion.
There isn't, yeah, there is no longer that power. When I was at university in Liverpool, if my car was parked somewhere where I thought, well, maybe it shouldn't be, I'd get a ticket, I'd write to the chief constable, and invariably he'd say, thank you very much, we've considered your request for annulation of the ticket. And invariably they would, with a letter, to see that you could read and write, and you know, you weren't some sort of maniac, they would overrule it because it was no big deal. But what happened is, sometime, somewhere, you've got to look back into the past and see, well, where did it all get simply monetized? Because that's what it's all about, money. Everything is money. You fail to take your kids to school, you get fined. If you take a holiday out of any intern time, they're talking about fining. If you park your car the wrong way around, it's a fine. If you go too fast, it's a fine. If you make, well, there's a whole plethora of things that you can and can't do, which results in a financial penalty. Council tax, not paid on time, not only is there the obligation to repay, but there's a fine. You can be imprisoned. So this whole sequence of fines has come out for a particular reason. And that isn't necessarily to raise more money, because they do have a lot of money available, but it's actually to criminalise your day-to-day living existence. Because statistically, in any given arrangement or any given area, there will always be the happenstance, the fact that you just don't have cash in your pocket and you're in a hurry, so you don't put the money in the meter, and while you're away for no more than 7 minutes, you get ticketed. The person that's slightly forgetful and runs the red light. Yeah, okay, but you're always going to have, by the law of probabilities, within a given catchment area of people, they're always like the roulette wheel at the casino. The house will always win, because on a margin of probability, you're always going to make a mistake eventually. So if you expand those sort of cobwebs far enough around, you're always going to have people getting trapped in different cobwebs. You might be very, very good, never get a parking ticket, never get a speeding fine for years, but someone else will catch you on another one. You'll go onto Morrison's car park, and like in Stoke-on-Trent, you sit down with someone, you think, oh great, no problem, we'll, like on Friday last week, sit down, have a chat, have a meal, you come off the car park and you find it took more than 2 hours, there's an £85 fine just parked there, just for parking your car, operated by an organisation called, I think it's called Parking Eye. These are the people who do the number plate recognition as you come on and come off. All of these companies on all the motorways and all the car parks around the country are set up with the permission and the tacit approval of something called the Association of Chief of Police Officers, ACPO. And so that association basically states how the society is going to be manipulated and operated from the type of product that the police wear, the type of initiatives and what type of cameras are going to be put on the streets, and right the way through a whole mass of policing policies that affect your daily lives. So, this is what it's all coming down to. Why is it all being monetized, and why is it that there's nothing that you can do these days that doesn't cost money? Even to go to the library, you can get your library card probably just about for free now. But a passport costs £75, I think, for a renewal. You have to even pay at the window if you want it to be checked. So the bottom line here is that it's money that's controlling everything here in our society, and therefore it's the people who are controlling the money supply that are obviously issuing the instructions. So most people then, if we look at is it the government that's controlling us, or is it the banking and finance community? And most people say, well, it's the politicians, because it's the politicians that decide from day to day what the laws are for everybody. But in fact, it's the bankers to which the politicians always have to go to obtain enough funds for their election or for their ideas. Because once they're in office, they have to get their money from somewhere for their projects. And so what you are is you're the counterfoil on the check. Yeah? So the government, with its so-called ideas and its manifestos and its policy, seem to want to take society in a particular direction. They can only do that with banking approval, and the person that's got to pick up the check for all of this is you, because you are supplying the energy, and you are the people, therefore, who are being taxed, and it's your taxation that's driving the whole machine. So it's a bit like a catch-22 situation then. It becomes, how do we get out of it, and is it possible to get out of it? So what I was looking at in 2012 is, and people will have heard this before, I maintain that there's these three principal legs on a stool which you're sitting on, like a milking stool. One is the, shall we say, inviolable human sovereignty. That's who you are. Answerable to God, answerable to your fellow man, but in a private personal capacity. Not predominantly answerable to a tyrannical Orwellian nightmare type state where no one's responsible, no one's accountable, but people end up black bagged and disappeared off to some type of secret court activity, where every regime that's ever existed in the past, whether it's Pol Pot, Stalin, Franco, Hitler, the biggest danger always to a community and a society isn't an external aggressor, it's always the dictator within the country itself. Stalin put more people to death than any other outside agency against the Russians, nearly 21 million. The same could be said of Adolf Hitler, Pol Pot, etc., down through history. So these are the people that you've got to be aware of and careful of, and this plotting is going on all the time, and it seems as if it's always been there, but there are certain stair steps through society where you say, you know, well, this is enough, we need to change now. But it's difficult. Look at the election that we've just had. A very good comment in the Daily Telegraph by one of the political columnists. He said, wow, excuse me, did I dream this? Because weren't we telling you for weeks beforehand it was going to be a hung parliament? Weren't we telling you this, that even the exit polls were saying it's going to be this way and it's going to be that way, we might not have a parliament till Christmas? So a lot of doubt and uncertainty, but by 10 o'clock on the evening of poll day, evidently, no, the Tories had won a landslide victory. Nigel Farage is gone, Miliband's gone. Now, the front page of the Telegraph the other day is that Middle England sees sense and comes to rescue a red tide that could have engulfed England or ruined the country. So you have to question whether you can believe all of this. And I would suggest to most people, you know, take it with a very large dose of medicine, because they're not beyond the ability to make things happen for their own, obviously, agendas. So what we were looking at then, or what I would have been looking at, is on these stools of the milking stool, the legs of the milking stool. First, you've got this one with an inviolable sovereignty. The second one is free energy. And people think, oh, maybe that exists, maybe it doesn't. Well, it does, and for those people who can reference this on YouTube, go and type in Neckermann. It's a firm in Germany. It's called a Neckermann Energy Tuner. That's spelled N-E-C-K-E-R-M-A-N. Neckermann are one of the prime sort of jewels in the Germanic crown, in a league with Tyson's, Krupp, Mercedes-Benz, etc. Neckermann specialise in wind power, and they specialise in solar energy.
but on, I think it was the 16th of February this year, they made an announcement that they were using zero-point energy, Tesla technology, to deliver their units, which are being produced now in the old East Germany, and these units will provide 5 kilowatt per day, and they are independently structured, attached within your room on a wall, and they will power the house. So I think there's a ploy here maybe to try and get it in through the back door, but I think in association with things like smart meters, there's not necessarily everything in the box would be good for your health, because along with smart meters, with all the top and also the toxic radio RF transmissions that are influencing society now, it could almost be like why there was more militancy in the 60s and 70s than there is today, is that everybody's having a harmonic vibration imposed upon us, where we're all seemingly feeling a little bit more docile and less prepared to be, disruptive, more willing to go along with the flow, and more willing to do what we are told to do. And so I totally believe that these attacks that are coming towards you and us and me are coming in multi-directional. They're not just coming in through the vaccines. They're not just coming through products in the food. They're not just coming through the airwaves. They're not just coming through these 56-inch plasma screen TVs where people are sitting in front of them and after now they're drooling down their chin. And all the tests show what the results of sitting in front of these things are. Yet we've all got them and they're all nailed on the wall. And so we're consenting to it. And this is the big thing with this constitutional perspective that I'm trying to weave now, now that I've come back over to England, and it looks like I'll probably be here for a while if the government has its way, if it's cancelled my cards, and I don't know about my passport yet, but we'll have to see. And that is to start knitting people together, to waking up to the fact that as long as you consent to it, they'll keep doing more. When they put these stories in the press and this is going to happen and this is going to happen, what it was called in the 50s and 40s in engineering parlance, especially in the aeronautical world, was shock testing. So what they do is they get an aircraft or a piece of engineered material and they would expose it to vibrational shock or banging or bouncing or whatever they wanted to do with it, and they would see how it would react. They find out where the strengths were, find out where the weaknesses are, then adjust the model, and then take it down the road and do it again. And so this is what's coming into your society now. You also have a condition, two other conditions that are running side by side. One is Stockholm Syndrome. And Stockholm Syndrome is the potential for an individual who's been tortured or abused to be nice to his torturer, on the hypothesis that the nicer he is, the less he'll torture him. Okay? And then the other aspect to it is something called learned helplessness. Two CIA psychologists, late last year, around about October, were parodied a little bit in the main newspapers because they'd received something like, I don't know, $3.5 billion in funding from the CIA and the NSA to look at the old paradigm of how do you make people actually comply. And the technique is simply to bombard the individual through whatever means possible with as much debilitating information and so much information that they can't react to, usually to make them what's called a feeling of despondency. So it's the flooding in Bangladesh, it's the earthquake somewhere, it's the fact that 30 people have just had their heads cut off on a beach by some guys, you know, called ISIS, which were just magicked up from somewhere and nobody had ever heard of them, and then, wow, suddenly they're on the world map, you know, threatening to invade Rome, you know? So you've got to ask yourself, along with Sandy Hook, along with 9/11, along with the false flag of Pearl Harbor, the 7/7/2005 catastrophe, where Tony Blair and his band come along and openly perpetrate a false flag on British soil, and this is why they never had and won't allow an investigation to be done on it. And this is why I went into the courts in 2007 before a guy called Judge Graham Richards and put 13 arrest warrants for Blair and his cabinet before the judge on these points and many other. And so I'm not new to what I'm doing, and this is one of the things that it brings me now to this point in time, that I've got this quest to push forward. I've taken this free man route of disconnecting from the state as best I could. I made several affidavits, I've served those on the Attorney General, I've served those on the Lord High Chancellor, who was at the time Kenneth Clark, and made very, very specific references to the fact that I cut myself free from the state, that I am not an asset of it, I am not subject to any of its alphabet organisations, I'm not in a situation where I'm going to be told what to do, and that I'll operate under common law and with what's something called like a liberating universal principle, that I'll treat others as they treat me, and we live by a golden rule of do unto others as you would have them do unto you, as long as you're not a sadomasochist, probably. Pardon?
Matthew 7:12.
Excellent. Well done, Matthew. I know you're not here, but you're just a reincarnation of him speaking, channeling. It's good. Okay. So the situation then is that we're at a point, it's quite critical. And what's going to happen after this meeting, you're all going to go your separate ways, and you'll end up at home tonight, and we'll all do the same things as we always do. And so the point is going to come further down the line where either you're all going to be on the next train to the equivalent of Auschwitz, or you're going to have done something about it. And the problem with the psychology surrounding this, it's the fish in the fish trap syndrome. Yeah? The fish goes into the fish trap, and the sides of the fish trap get narrower and narrower until the fish gets to a point where it can't actually turn around anymore within its own body length, and so has to keep on swimming down. So they're very crafty. There's quite a good document, and some people say it's a falsehood, but it makes very good reading. It's on a level with 1984 by George Orwell. It's called Silent Weapons for a Quiet War. If you haven't read it, get it on the internet and read it. And if I was going to be the writer of a document of implementation of psychological and spiritual warfare perpetrating on a mass of people, then I would have been happy to have written it, especially when you look at it supposedly drafted in 1952. Didn't have computers yet. They were talking about that then. They were talking about barcoding. They were talking about getting the women into the workplace so they could split the nucleated family and having both of them working equally long hours with still less money coming in at the end of the week or the month than they had before. So this program, this Oppo Saves program, for the like of David Icke refers to, whether it's conservative or whether it's Labour, is like the head of the serpent going down the road. Huh? The coils go left and right, but the head just stays straight down the middle. And we're all watching like this, going, oh, there's the manifesto, there's there's the new Labour, there's Miliband, coached by Tony Blair, going, I want to make this absolutely clear. Yeah? Remember, Blair used to do that. He used to do that hand gesture, and he used to go, oh, he's really coached you well, Mr. Miliband, you know? And so you've got Tony Blair and his gang now, Bob Diamond, ex-CEO of Barclays, running around raping, pillaging, and doing everything they can possibly do to set up Barclays or Bob Diamond's empire now in Africa. I think in 2012, Tony Blair and associates spent $26 million on travel and, should we say, hospitality alone. So it's a very lucrative business. These politicians all taking their 100 grand, no more, a year until they're out of office. But then when you see people like David Cameron sitting there, married to one of the family of the Astor, yeah, and many times in New York, big I think they're the family that own Waldorf Astoria. So anything to do with Astor and Jacob Astor from the time long ago. So he's married well into a connected family on the East Coast. He's the 10th cousin to the Queen. Yeah, you all know that, or most of you. He was at Eton with his big friends and chums, Boris Johnson, Nathan Rothschild, and his mate next door at number 11, Gideon Oliver Osborne. That's his real name. So what are the chances of those guys going from Eton, then going into Cambridge, being all connected and members of the I think it's called the Bullingdon Club, notoriously a quite infamous club for, trashing nightclubs and doing whatever they want because their rich fathers can pay. And Cameron's father made his wealth predominantly through arranging offshore financial transactions for people in the city through the 60s, 70s, and probably 80s and on to today. So this is the target. This has to be called the enemy because they are the ones in the club. And it's the same club they use to beat you over the head day in, day out. And they're in it, and you're not in it, and you're never going to be in it. Because that's just, unfortunately, the not-so-good news. So, is it changeable? Why would anybody come along and say, well, what chance have we got now? Why could I, not just me, but we, suggest a method of changing it that would work now, whereby the great and the good before had failed successively? I mean, everybody's been at it. Gandhi was at it. JFK was at it in his way. Martin Luther King was at it. Diana was at it. Snowden was probably, in a way. Those have heard, supposedly, someone called Karen Hudes from the World Bank. Yeah, maybe. People like Julian Assange hold up now. Over 2 years in the Ecuadorian embassy. So there are many sort of people trying to do it, but they're coming always from a position of I suppose, inefficiency because of what they're looking to achieve. You're not going to be able to overthrow the system by just trying to use the system. So what came out of this this scenario was to try and look at this then other leg on the milking stool, and that was the banking and finance community. Because they are the people who call the shots, that's where all the money is, and it's very strange that all the people here in this room, and even business owners, the owner of probably this racetrack down the road here, compared with the banking elite, are quite penniless at the end of the month. So how come it is the few that 0.00001% of the population of the planet that are controlling the banking wealth that are the most obscenely wealthy on the planet? It must say something that if you want to have money, you've got to be into the banking business. So this is all like the Summers, the Geithners, the Greenspans, the Bernankes, the Mervyn King clan, the new guy from Canada in charge of the Bank of England. Canadian, Carney, is it? Mark Carney. So it's got to be something that's monetized, and it's got to be something that's got to be flown in. And we've either got to disconnect from their world, or you're going to have to remain in it. And it's a polarity identity, really, with this. And so in 2007, I made a bit of a statement to myself when I was sitting in my camping car in France, thinking, do I ever go back to England and can I be bothered? Because I've got this sort of a bipolar attitude. I like to come back and I want to try and change it for good. And then the other is that there doesn't seem to be much you can do, and through 2010, 11, 12 particularly, there was nobody for me to speak to. And so now, in a way, it's proved it was a good thing to do, because, wow, somebody had said a year or two ago, I'd have been standing up in a room sometimes of 50, 60, 100 odd people. then I would have said, yeah, I wait for the day. So this Peter of England saga began, and it was a deliberate attempt to say to the government that the individual, if it's done correctly, has the right to adjust his life and live his life accordingly on fairly standard, well-acknowledged, incontrovertible common law principles that are basically almost common sense principles. They've been there and they've always been there, and unfortunately what's happening now is it's all being buried under a sea of statutory authority. So it's bringing it back now to this kernel, or this nub on the wheel now, which you're going to have to try and grasp. And I'll over the coming weeks and months escalate this to a more identifiable level, where I'll produce documents. I mean, the first tranche here is the Weir Bank thing, the checks going out, 10,000 checks gone out over the country, and the bankers don't know what to do with them. But the idea is, we've got to get people woken up to this constitutional point of who you are and who this state is. Because if you say, well, who is the state? Where is it, officer? Well, it's in Westminster. Well, no, that's just the 650 MPs now, and then the House of Lords. But what about the Cabinet? No, it's not them, and it's... Is it the judiciary, you know? No, it's not the judiciary, you know? And so the Buddhists teach that if you actually look at all the parts to a given thing, and everyone is identified as not the one, the group or the entirety cannot be it. It's just not logical. So if you ask, is it? No. How can a group of negatives be a positive? It's impossible. So what you've got to realize is it's reasonably simple. The constitution that is emitting all these laws onto you, about 98% of them are not acts of parliament. Okay? They're called an act of parliament, but there are different things within Parliament. There are, and forgive me, the people who probably heard this, I don't know whether I actually covered it a few weeks ago. There's primary legislation, which is the bill is introduced, it has its first reading, it has its second reading, it might then go to committee stage for adjusting, and then it goes to debate before the House, and then finally it's sent up to the House of Lords, and then they can sort of backtrack it a little bit, but they can't delay it infinitely. And then eventually it receives the royal seal or the royal assent, and that becomes a law. Because of the sheer weight of legislation that these overactive, zealous governments now are trying to churn out to restrict you and control you and dominate you in every manner possible, it's totally against the teachings of Christ if you're Christic. It's totally against the teachings of Buddha if you're of a Buddhist disposition, and certainly against Hinduism and almost every other, you know, should we say, even Islam, consensual religion on the planet. So you've got to ask yourself, why are they doing it and what's driving it? So there's the question. Why are they doing it? What's the end game? Because there is one. So, with this legislation, 98% of it that's hitting you is what's called, it's an executive order, and it's coming from a committee, and it's called a statutory instrument. And the statutory instruments are suggested by Whitehall within what's called the executive department, and they go to the ministerial office, and he puts a committee together, and they put something together. And then eventually, when they're happy with the way this legislation wants to run, whether it's parking tickets, whether it's adjustments to community tax, whether it's adjustments with the health service, whether it's the health service now becoming privatized, in fact, what it is, you've got all these outside agencies, so it might as well be private because it's all private through the back door. That document then gets laid on a desk in the House of Commons for 40 days, and if it isn't objected to, it then comes into law. And therefore, when the policeman stops you now, let's use an analogy, at the side of the road and says, dependent what his intentions are, Have you got your license and your insurance on you, mate? No. Well, in the old days, yeah, Road Traffic Act 1988, right the way up till 2005, you had 7 days to produce your documents. People remember that? Yeah. And what you did, if you'd been silly enough not to have insurance, you quickly phone your broker and say, can you sort me a backdated cover note out, mate? And everything went on, and, you know, as long as you hadn't had an accident, you know, that might be a bit different. So, same with the license. You always got a ticket, and it was what's called a notice to produce your documents. So in those days, it was all quite still nice and friendly, and there was discretion, and people could, you know, you could move. But now it's tightened right the way down to the point now under the Serious Organised Crime and Police Act 2005, that if you haven't got insurance or you can't produce your driving licence there and then with the counterparty, that's the old paper but with the other one, then they have the option of seizing the vehicle. Okay? Because what you're supposed to be engaged in there is serious organised crime. And the serious organised crime aspect of all this was set up by, it's a private company. Yeah? And so if you go into the parliamentary legislation, you can see what it can and can't do. And that's all run through the Association of Chief of Police Officers, which are all the most senior police officers in the land, doing what they do best. And invariably, I'd say 85% of them have to be Freemasons. And if you're not, you don't get into a higher percentage. Yeah, okay, I was being courteous because sometimes my numbers sound as if it's off the scale. So this is really what we're up against. How many Masonic lodges, don't answer if you're at one of the meetings, how many Masonic lodges in the United Kingdom? Anyone hazard a guess? Roughly? 10,000 lodges. So 10,000 lodges up and down the country. Let's say there's about 100 Freemasons in each lodge. A number? What's that? Right. How many people just voted in the last election, do they say? About 50? 50 million, they say? Okay, so 50 million, so 1/50 of the population, not including some, these don't include the female lodges or the female aspect of membership. So you've got 1 in 50 of an organization that's set up as a secret or private organization, of which you're not a member, and they're in key points throughout councils, architecture, banking, finance, NHS. So 1 in 50. So there'll be at least one in here in any sort of group around the country, and on. And they're all connected, and they've got a code. They, for the people who don't know, they are Baal worshipping, yeah, the god Baal or Baalek. It was on Mount Carmel, and it was the prophet, is it Emmanuel, who put 400 and something of the priests of Baal to death when they put the, remember, they put the carcass of the bull into the pit and commanded Baal to ignite it, and it failed. That was a previous reincarnation of John the Baptist, by the way. That's why he lost his head and why Jesus supposedly didn't have the right to intervene, because
John the Baptist was the fake Jesus Christ.
Okay, well, maybe stepped on a landmine there with a priest in here, so we'll put a cut on that. Maybe he was the original. Okay, right. So anyway, we won't go down that one because never, that's why I always say, never mix religion and politics. So thank you for coming, by the way. Peace, love and happiness. So this is what I'm trying to kindle in the country. It's got to wake up. You've got to do something about it. And if you live in fear, they've already won. And you're going to go, you're going to die a thousand deaths. A bit like with Stephen Fry in Viva Vendetta. You see it when he's got a copy of the Quran in his basement, and he says, if I ever get caught, that's the least of my worries. And eventually, you know, the nightmare scenario arrives where they bang on the door and take him away. That's how it's always ended the same way. There's an agenda running. There is a fear-generating mechanism there to keep us all, you know, compliant. So as to where all that's going for, you know, longer term, we don't really want to go down, because we're talking really more about this, the Weir Bank idea. But I'm really just trying to underpin why I'm doing it, because I've just had the PayPal account frozen by people who are supposedly us, right? So let's just take these tendrils of electrification now out here. And you people aren't really looking to lynch me, you know, or say he's this and he's that. And if you were, I would suggest, well, just go and have a look what I've put out on the on YouTube and you know, these other areas since 2012. Maybe speak to people about what I was doing for 10 years before that, sort of living almost in a camping car on my own, living in a cave in Spain. You know, it's not the pedigree for someone who's coming to try and make a quick 10 quid or rip you off. And so what's happened with PayPal is they phoned me up about 3 weeks ago when I was in France. I wanted to know what was being traded on the account. So I explained to the lady what was happening, and her name was Tanya, if she's listening, PayPal, Ireland. And what she said is, oh no, okay, that sounds fine. And I said, well, you know, we're doing very well. Members are coming on all the time. We're expected to continue. And she said, okay, well, if there's a change, another team will be in touch with you. So 2 weeks later, just over, we see that the account had been frozen. And it wasn't frozen, this was just 2 days ago now, it wasn't frozen for any type of complaint, it was just frozen. So I got on the phone and asked various questions, spent over 2-3 hours explaining over the course of a day and a half. And evidently there was one person that had made a complaint, then it had come in. And so that it drifted a little bit, and they said, fine, no, somebody would get back to you. So I got phoned then on election day from a guy from India, 10 o'clock in the morning. He says, I'm here to resolve the situation. We went through everything. He said, no, I'm quite happy with all of that. We'll take all the filters off, all the blocks off, no problem as far as I'm concerned, and I'll send you a confirmation email within 5 minutes. And 3 hours later, nothing had happened. So I got back in touch and found out, yes, what had happened is he, the regional manager or the guy who's in charge of them, he'd taken them off, but within 5 minutes, a superior team of investigators had put them back on again. And that's where they stay. They're not appealable towards. You can't find out who they are, where they are, or what they're about. And in a way, I'm not surprised, but it's the fact it's non-accountable. So you don't know where they are. So the next thing then is this comes on with the bank. So they've stopped the bank account as well. So no money can go in, no money can go out, yet nobody's spoken to me at all about this. So a business has been put out of business simply by the fact that these people have decided that that's the way they want to play it. So the idea for us going forward now is, how many people are familiar with the idea or the concept of Weir Bank? Who's heard of it? Yeah, most people in the room.
Do you want to run over it?
Yeah, so quickly to run through what it's set up to do is, on the website up until a couple of days ago or a day ago here, you could have taken a leaflet off. And what it would have said is, just hold that there. People's banking system, legal money with finality of settlement, common law banking, totally unique, a public bank, an employment provider, solves all financial dilemmas, morally sound, 100% protected and 100% safe. And then there's a quotation on the front cover. It's by a guy called Lord Acton, which was a historian. Died in, I think it was 1920. It says, the issue which has swept down the centuries and which will have to be fought sooner or later is the people versus the banks. Mervyn King, when he left office, virtually said the same thing. It's in a critical situation and something's got to give. So the rationale behind We're Bank is to go back into the money supply and make people realize the nature of money and how it's created, and then give it back to them so that they can deal with their in their private capacity, one with each other, without there having to be a third party involved in it who's charging interest on that, and then the government stepping in fact doing its taxation thing. And then the other artificial mechanism, inflation. Because all of these are artificially introduced and it's supposed to be the economic model that works like that. But what it is in effect is some banker behind the screen with a wheel which he just turns whenever he wants to increase the flow, or like a rheostat on an electric circuit. The more they want in and the less they want in. They just simply turn this wheel. So the idea is to look at what the nature of money is, to try and give it back to you, and then find out, does it work? And most definitely it does. The only thing in existence on the planet to pay for anything, anytime, anywhere, are goods and services. There isn't anything called money. Money doesn't really exist to pay for anything. It's just a facilitation. That can be proved by the fact that everything out there, everything you see, is a goods or a service. Whether it's a candle or whether it's somebody coming and rewiring your house or providing a service, pushing a wheelchair, washing your car, those are all the mechanisms that generate something that comes out of it. So the unit of exchange that comes out of it then is just whatever you decide it to be. So if I give this chap here now a 100 euro note, if he's got any sense, he'll take it, and I'll say, get me a beer, keep the change. He'd probably go down to the bar and the guy says, sorry, mate, can't touch that. Yeah, it's worth probably about £80. So it's the concept of it. He gets in his car and goes on the ferry into France, someone will mug him for it. But here he can't give it away. So we've got to see this mechanism of, depending on what country you're in, another different type of piece of paper is worth something. So we could come up with our own. And this is what the nature of We're Bank was, and this unit of currency called the Ri. And I'm not going to labour. Don't worry, I'm not going to labour you on the intricacies of it. You can get that later. But the mechanism of how it works is to do the following: that we see that the banks are unfair. Everybody knows what they're doing, but they don't quite know how they do it. It's like looking at David Copperfield when he makes the 747 jumbo jet disappear at JFK Airport. And people are standing there thinking, wow, how do they do that? It's like, it's magic. Yeah? And there's a guy, I think it's called Ken Galbraith, who says, the ease at which the bankers make money repels the mind. It's so easy. It's just that easy. They create it with their account book. When the Bank of England was first set up, one of the Scotsmen who set it up, William Paterson, I think it was 1688 or something, and Bank of England that then came in, I think 1694.
95.
Was it 95? Thanks. They didn't have... They said they were going to put, let's say, 1.5 million in, or 125,000, I can't remember, but something like that. They didn't have enough. So the three or five of them put the money in, and then they made a loan for the rest out of the bank which they created to set up the Bank of England. So it's just sheer trickery. It's fractional reserve currency speculation. And at the moment, the total amount of debt and derivatives in the world, that's all the amount of outstanding money, is in the region of about 1 quadrillion. And a billion is 9, a trillion is 12, and so then we go on to 15 digits. That's zeros after the... So it's a lot. And keep that in perspective, from the time of supposed Jesus' birth, if we take that as zero, to here, 2015 to today, if you'd spent £1 million a day from that point to now, you still would not have even spent £1 trillion. It's £1 million a day. And if you put all this in perspective energetically, if you look at this, and it's been calculated, the amount of energy used not only to create a panzer tank in the Second World War, but the energy that it produced when it fires a shell, there was more energy in that one unit than the entire William the Conqueror, who was the Hastings guy, the guy who had the arrow shot?
Harold.
Yeah, for the entire conquest and battle around 1066. Because they didn't have that type of energy, you know? It was horses, and it was arrows, and it was a few boulders being thrown. So we've moved in a bit of a paradigm, because let's say the first, the invention of the internal combustion engine, Robert Louis Stevenson. Any idea when the first rail...
It was about 1840.
Okay. 1840, 1940, 175 years to today. Up until that point, forever, the fastest you could go anywhere, unless anyone can correct me, was at the speed you could walk on a horse or on a boat. You couldn't do it any quicker. There was no way you could do it.
How come they're digging up 30,000-year-old jet aircraft?
Well, that's something, Reverend, that we shall talk after the break in the ET scenario thing, but I'm trying to keep it simple for now. But yeah, I totally agree with you. So yeah, and all the history that's been taught is a crock. But apart from that, just to keep the integrity of this argument now that's been blown out of the water, but for what you're taught in school, the mind washing technique, the 9 till 5 curfew, so the parents can go off and work, we've had a massive change in speed. And now you can go around the world probably in 12 hours, and you're going to get HS2 rail networks because we want them, because the trains are so packed and we can all afford to travel, not. But they keep dishing this out. So the situation we're in, therefore, is we've got to come along and we've got to try and jump the track. So we've either got to take this system down 100%, which involves effort, or we've got to park up alongside it and go down the street saying, well, fine, this is our model and we like to sort of play with this, and we won't bother you too much, so please don't bother us. Now, I would suggest that's an inviolable right of the individual under the Universal Declaration of Human Rights, which probably isn't all it's made out to be, but it's never quoted anymore. And a mass of other so-called human rights legislation, which tends to profess that you've got these rights. But unfortunately, these rights are almost like the rights that a chimpanzee has in Whipsnade Zoo. It can do whatever it wants as long as it stays in the cage, doesn't bite the keeper, and it's all conditional. So there's something that's got to give, we think, and I hope you'll agree, but how we make it give is the tip point or the choke point. So with this weir bank model, what we decided to do, or what I decided to do, was to come along and duplicate the banking model. And the fact is that there's a method, therefore, of either fighting the banking model or going with it. And most people are drowning in a sea of debt. Most people are being asked to provide council tax, or being having them houses repossessed because they've got behind in the mortgage. They've got credit card debts that they can't pay. These are all ensuring bailiff actions and all the rest of it. So we decided to look for an answer, and it has to be within the money supply and the way things are financed. So let's look what they do. If you go to the bank and want to borrow some money, they make an assessment of what you can pay. And when you go for a mortgage or a car loan or any of these loans, the first thing they do, they want to know what you've got and what you're working and what you're earning, and if there's anything left at the end, then they'll squeeze something out and a bit more, because they're just hoping that they can get you before, you know, the shutter comes down. And it's all based, therefore, on a promise to pay energy over time. And so I looked at that and said, well, it's quite obvious, and everybody says it in the banking community, without the signature on the piece of paper, as any car salesman, any double glazing salesman, anyone that's offering you a mortgage deal or any type of contract will testify, if you fail to get the signature of the individual on the contract, you're going to have to go back and get them to put it on, unless you're going to forge it. Yeah? And the banks aren't beyond doing that. But most people would have to go back and have it done again. So this is what is then being created within Weir Bank. What we've come along and done is said, you have the ability to pay these bills. They are your ancestral birthright. They are coming from monies that are apportioned to you and that are yours by right. And so the game is you, in effect, create your own promissory note, promise to pay, and a certain amount, but instead of presenting that and trying to foist it on EDF or Santander, who are chasing you for money, you don't try and force it upon them, because where these examples have been perpetrated in the courts, Wesley Ahmed, who's supposed to be coming here, was supposed to be coming later, I think he's got the story, and I've heard it from one or two others, where they've tried to present a promissory note in the court to the magistrate, but what the magistrate's done when he's tried to present it, says, sorry, I can't force the plaintiff's solicitor to accept it. So you've got this sort of, don't touch me with it, I don't want to take it. So with a banking arm, as an independent third party, you're now firmly in the laws of banking, the Bills of Exchange Act, and everything to do with promissory notes and negotiable financial instruments. Mortgage-backed residential securities, all this stuff, Freddie Mae and Freddie Mac that you might have heard of that all collapsed in the United States. MBRS, I think, mortgage-backed residential securities, all bundled up in hundreds, duplicated, robo-signed, nobody knew, purchasing toxic debt, etc. So we created a model that's purer, is transparent and directly associated and attributable to the person that's involved in it. So the idea is that we get the individual to release himself from all this barrage of monetized fraudulent debt that's been perpetrated on him from every direction possible. And instead of getting into a confrontational situation with bailiffs and the courts, we took the attitude of, right, let's just say to people, pay it. There is enough money there, except you don't have the keys to the coffers, but the money is there. So what we'll do is we'll create it for you. So with the promissory note in place, the checkbooks were then put into place, and so any individual who'd joined and become a member of the organisation because we needed a membership base, because we're trying to build this organization called Re-Movement. And but then everything can go on it. Recall, re-movement, redesign, reassess. Everything that's wrong about society, we want you just to re it. Even to the extent you can actually deselect the MP once he's actually in place for malfeasance in public office. So if he's not actually doing what you, as a electoral ward, think he should do, to get a body of votes together, just one more than the majority that pulled him in, and under common law, hook him out. You don't have to wait for 5 years. Hoik him out now. Put someone else in who you think will do the job. So the idea then was that you put a sound banking model in that the banking community mirror. They understand it. They know that there's a Bills of Exchange Act. They know it regulates all of their banking practice. They know it comes from way, way back. They understand it. Every convention that's really come in on the banking side, even the United Nations Convention on International Bills of Exchange and Promissory Notes in 1988, formulated in Geneva, all the acceptance for value, Uniform Commercial Code in the United States, which is a global trading platform, all recognizes and identifies the instruments that you have to use if you want to create and channel money. So, this is what we've put together. We have the bank in name. We have the promissory notes. We have then the checkbooks that clear on the individual's promissory note. So there is no point in the sequence at all where the banks could come along or the judge and say, this is a hypothetical situation. You are claiming that you have a value, when in fact you don't have a value. All you have is, well, what is value? We have exactly the same documentation, and we have the same papers that the banks have. In fact, we have more, because we know where they are, we know where they came from, and the individual has the ability to pay them down quite easily, and we know they haven't been monetized. And contrary to what some of these shills and trolls are saying on the internet, the other week they're saying that I've taken them all and sold them to the Chinese. Yeah? The operation is very, very insidious, very vindictive, and it comes out of the United States, because they were saying what was going to be happening even before I knew anything. Over 2 weeks ago, these are guys in the United States, websites run out of somewhere, or incorporated in Nevada, and they were saying, why hasn't someone been in touch with PayPal to report this?
Is this Quadloos, Peter?
Yeah.
They've been at it since the beginning of April.
Yeah.
If you read the links.
Yeah, I did.
They were ganging up and saying, I'm going to report him, and then they put letters up.
It started off, is Peter of England the real guru? That's how it started. Okay. And then it moved on to, why hasn't someone contacted the FSA? Why hasn't someone contacted the Prudential Regulatory Authority? Why hasn't someone got in touch? So they've been quite methodical. And the type of question and threads, you wouldn't get these type of questions from normal people. You know, they've got a tenacity, they've got a corrosiveness and an agenda that is just like, trash it no matter what. And the only vindicating point, and whether I end up speaking to another group again or not, this is why it's important for you to see it or hear it coming from the horse's mouth, is it's not true, because one, I'm here, I'm standing here doing it. It's got a perfect track record. I've had some of the best contributors of various forums get in touch with me and said, even Michael Abernasia, who's coming in a couple of weeks' time, you've nailed it. It's bulletproof. So don't care what anyone tells you out there that, no, you can't do that because The sort code isn't recognised. It's fraud. You're passing a fraudulent check. Look at what the definition of fraud is. Yeah. The sort code. I've had conversations with. I've had conversations on Friday. A guy called John from NatWest Clearing. I've had UK Clearing on. I've had EcoBank. I think in Bradford. I've had Yorkshire Bank, Post Office counters on. I've had Clydesdale Bank. And I've had the Royal Ontario Bank of Montreal on. I've had Chrysler Canada on. I've had all these people coming. I've had Bromley Borough Council, John May, if you're listening, asking me how we clear the checks. What do we have to do to clear them? And I take my hat off to most of these people who phoned. None of them have said, apart from UK Clearing, who tried to intimate I was involved in some type of fraudulent activity, or maybe correct that, that I was misleading my customers because they were told that they could do this and we've got to return it, so I'm not speaking the truth. So nobody, apart from these
quangos.
Whatever, no, that organisation there whose name I can't even pronounce. I love you. Yeah, are saying these nasty things, you see? And so if they'll sit down and if they'll listen and if we can go into any court in the land to present one of the checks. Is anybody who's not seen them? I'll just, the principle is that they look like a check, they are like a check, and they clear like a check. Now, what all the major clearing banks would say is that because the major clearing banks would say they can't be cleared because the sort code's non-existent, okay, or it's invalid, which is a crafty way of trying to say, you know, there's something not quite right there. So the sort code is that, these were done quite some time ago as the first draft by the company. You read there. The original company that were putting these together were so meticulous that if I hadn't have made the corrections, they would have had these go out with National Westminster PLC still printed on them. And they'd even left the National Westminster watermark on the final proof. So I had to tell them. So anyone that comes along and says, oh, this guy's trying to pass things off, I actually have the record and the proofs that I sent back to say, no, sorry, we don't want NatWest on there, we don't want a logo on it. And I had my first meeting with these people called Communisys, or Commune with ISIS, in 2012. So this is a very, very slow burn, and I was methodical. And unbeknownst to a lot of people, the day the checks were due for delivery and just about to be loaded on the TNT courier, they phoned me up and cancelled the delivery. And I had a chat with a guy, I think his name was Kent Farrell, and I spoke at great length with him, saying, you know, they had ample opportunity of cancelling before, but he was quite concerned that they didn't really want to be associated with it because they do all the security printing for the major banks. But we got around it, thanks to him, and or not to him, should I say. And so on and on we went. So what we were looking to do is to put a real plausible product together, because you have to fulfill certain things if you want to, you know, if you want to pass something off as a duck, it's got to really walk like a duck and quack and look like a duck. However, people should be aware you can write a check on anything. You can write it on a table napkin, you can write it on this tabletop, and as one farmer did, I think, in some dispute with NatWest several years ago, he wrote it on the side of a cow. And it's valid, because they have to process it. All they have to do is take the details off And what you'll find now, what they can or can't do regards processing, in effect, this is what's been happening, is that the lady's just handed this to me, so I'll just prove a point, and then I'll disprove my own point, and then what we'll do is in future years or months, we'll go from there. This is just submitted here, probably just keep my finger over, I'll read it out. So
most people know me anyway.
Okay, but I don't know whether we want it going over there. So I'll put my thumb over it, and I don't know whether we can. We could just zoom in it before I take it back again. Okay, so we've had many people phone me up. For example, American Express got in touch with a lady, said that the check had cleared. We've had council tax zeroed. We've had Barclay card zeroed. We've had Barclay card accounts zeroed. This one here, I'll just read out here. It's addressed to the lady in the room here. Let's just call her June, even though it's May. Okay. So, dear June, this is from United Utilities. Thank you for your recent payment of 1,354.51 that we received on the 30th of April. I can now confirm that your account balance is now paid in full. Okay. Now, some people might say, oh, yeah, well, that's just one and they didn't check it, pardon the pun. But if you were going on the website, there's a small video by the Check and Credit Clearing Company, which shows the basic procedure of how a check clears, and after a certain period of days, you can't renege on it. It is clear if after the sixth day, the funds can't be taken out of the account. So a lot of these checks, people have said that they've been returned, the banks are returning them to the customer, and telling the customer that we, a bank, refuse to clear them. Now, I have the phone on the checks, there is a hotline number, there is nobody else picking the phone up. It's on from 8:30 in the morning till around about 6 at night, sometimes later, because people from Canada and the United States can phone. There's only me doing the clearing. So I'm going on the record here now for everybody that I have not refused one check if anyone's phoned up to ask, will it clear? So we take the check number, we just ensure that the individual hasn't exceeded their 150,000 limit on a check, and we say it's good and we clear it. The Bromley Borough Council didn't know quite how they should clear it, so I suggested that they take a photocopy of the check, send the photocopy to us at our registered address, and from that point on, we would clear it, and then we would transfer funds to them in whatever way they needed to have that done. So under something now called the Deregulation of the Bills of Exchange Act 1996, there is something called presentment of a check for payment, alternative means of presentment. So a banker may present a check for payment to the banker on whom it is drawn by notifying him of its essential features by electronic means or otherwise, telephone, fax, instead of by presenting the check itself. So that means if they want to phone me up and say, well, we've got this check here, and I say, well, does it look good on its face? Yeah. Could you give me the amount? Could you give me the person's name? Is the signature seemingly in order, etc.? Then we can clear that over the phone, or we can clear it by fax. So there's nothing to dispute there. The other thing that all the checks go out, or should go out, with something called an allonge attached to them. And this allonge here covers two things. It's a double-sided. Allonge is French. It's where you get the word a lounge chair from, or lounger. No, not you, lounger. No. Yeah, so it's it goes to the side, and that basically sets out what the payee, the receiver of that check, must do with it. One part is non-acceptance. If they refuse to accept it, the individual, the drawer of the check, is released from their liability on the instrument. And then if they accept it but refuse to present it for clearing, again, the liability of the drawer of the check is excused or extinguished immediately. So if they return it, if they return the check to the individual and say, basically, we neither accept it or present it, then within 3 days, you just make something called a notarial protest. And that notarial protest is simply a confirmation to the payee that you are protesting that bill of exchange, promissory note, or negotiable financial instrument for him not having done. You have it witnessed by two witnesses or a notary. So if there's no notary available, just get two householders to verify your signature. Send it off, and then it's closed. Okay? Now, people say, oh, well, they still say my account is show. Now, they've readjusted it again. They took 600 off or 800 off. Now, they've put it back on again. Yeah? So what? Remember that this was primarily...
Hello, sorry.
Okay. This was primarily a defensive tactic, what we've created here. We haven't created something for you to get another... a 500 SL Mercedes, or we haven't created it so you can get a Heimer camper car fresh out of the car showroom, or that you can go off and buy a small property somewhere or a timeshare. We've done it for those people, and it's been no shadow of a doubt from day one. It's done as a defensive mechanism to stop you having your house repossessed, to stop the bailiffs knocking your doors through, to stop your car being towed by the finance company, to stop your credit cards, your way of life that, society almost demands that you live by now being taken away, to stop your utilities ending up with you being in court and an earnings attachment order put on you. Whatever it is on that side, this is what it's designed to do, and it was also designed to send a bow shot across the banking community that enough's enough. Now, to my mind, the genie's out the bottle. Yeah? It's not been done before. Michael Bernasia was talking about, he thought in 2012, I think it was one of his videos when he spoke to Manchester Northwest or something like that, where he mentions the fact that there's a bank on the other side of the world that was trying to set up some situation where they would accept promissory notes and they could form some type of currency. And if you go and actually find out who they were. It's parked up on...
Terry Campbell, New Zealand.
Was it? I'm not sure whether that was the one, but this one I saw was... It seemed to be like in the middle of the Cayman Islands, or was there another one registered somewhere? I don't know. But that defeats the object of the exercise, because if we can do it, why not do it here? We've got nothing to run from. We're not stealing. I'm not doing anything that the people who joined and provided the promissory notes haven't given permission and a desire to do. The problem was, it started off 10 to 15 people a day joining. It soon increased to 25 to 30. And by the time PayPal pulled the button, it was averaging about 35 people a day coming on board. So it was going like this. They were coming in from New Zealand, from Australia, from South Africa, from Canada, from the United States. We've got people from Buffalo, New York, people from Sacramento in California coming on. I mean, it's going very well. And I say it was going. It still is. But now what we've got to do is readjust the way that it moves on. So in total, this is just for the number crunchers out there, the people who say I'm funding some extravagant type of lifestyle when I can just about pay for the petrol to get here today type of thing. After all, so around about 240 checkbooks in total had gone out. Let's say we stick with 200. You can see it, £25 a book. Yeah. Then we've got the costs of putting them together. If they're printed in the UK, recorded delivery, first class, Royal Mail next day, that's about two, depending on the weight, sometimes they creep up, about £2.46 a chuck. If we send them to Canada, it's £9.46 a book, and the same to Australia, I think, and New Zealand, are £10 a time to send the book. So, you know, we're not, I'm not going to be living on some island and retiring very soon, because now we can also see I can't make refunds and I can't put anybody back into a better position than they were as of election day, the 7th, that's when it all happened, because the amount that's in the PayPal account now is frozen and I can't make refunds or do anything. So for the future, taking it forward, we're probably going to have to move into another scenario, which I won't necessarily cover now, but we might have to have a little break, because I think you've done very well, especially as I'm not using PowerPoint and I'm not putting pictures up there, because I didn't bring my PowerPoint presentation today, because I'm having certain things backed up, as I explained before. So what we could do maybe is take a, is it good to take a little break now? Then we can have questions and things after. So, right, I'll try and, I've got the luxury of having a little bit more time than I anticipated, because unfortunately, Wes, wherever you are, isn't here for this part now. So we'll have some questions in a moment. And what I'd like to just cover though in this area now is some sort of more sort of less conventional ideas on sort of like banking and finance. As you'll appreciate, with the degree of supposed intelligence that is invested or recruited by these banking cartels globally, whether it's merchant banks, whether it's private or commercial banks, whether it's insurance companies, whether it's companies like Goldman Sachs or JP Morgan or Barclays Derivatives, wherever they operate globally, they're always looking for the next con and the next fix. Typically, sort of in the 80s, you might have, you wouldn't have heard of it maybe, but there was a book entitled, I think it was called Blood in the Water, and it was an expose of the JP Morgan tactics for selling bonds and various types of securities to the equivalent of the local councils in the United States, and some of the tactics they used and the incentives that these brokers were offered, where some of them could earn a million a week with depending on what type of bonds they were selling. And they all knew that they were toxic and that they would ruin pension funds, and that they would cause people in 10 to 15 years' time, when they were long left the business, to be left in a state where they couldn't pay for their pensions or their livelihoods. So what you're dealing with predominantly, exclusively, is sociopaths and psychopaths. Full stop. Don't try and give your left brain, right brain, well, they're just well-meaning, or oh, you know, if I was in that situation, I think I'd do it too. No, the profiling of these individuals is invariably they're narcissistic, they are precocious, there's an attention to detail, they have very fractious personalities, and they have to be like that, because if you've either just lost or won the amounts of money that they profess that they can and do, and that the front pages of the newspapers will show that, in fact, they do, then you've got to have a particular type of predisposition to sit down and do whatever you do without becoming too, so we say, mentally unhinged of an evening. You get this social profiling as well in the police these days. There's a negative profiling now in the police and all the security services, not a positive one. They're looking more for that robotic, knee-jerk, psychopathic, hey mom, don't I look good in this, as they pull the trigger and take someone's head off. So This is really what you're up against, and the degree of discernment or intelligence within these communities now is long gone, and you're getting into almost a societal robotic on the street in preparation for what the European Union would have patrolling you and looking after your interests if this piece of legislation that's currently being debated is allowed to go through. And it's something called LAW. You might not have heard of it. It stands for Lethal Autonomous Weapon. And the Lethal Autonomous Weapon is the European Parliament now debating whether these robotic... what's that chap, Matt Damon, when he's in that recent film where they live in that wheel? Oblivion, is it?
Elysium.
If you've seen the film Elysium... Or when Matt Damon is standing in line with a shaven head, ready to be put on the bus to go to the Dynacorp type factory that makes these things, you see these robots patrolling up and down the line, and they look more real than the Terminator type thing. But if you see the next Terminator film that's due in the cinema soon, you can see it's all very freaky stuff. And so the bottom line in all of this, harking back to whatever the Monseigneur was saying earlier, is that this technology is there, it is available, it's extraterrestrially back-engineered, and in many instances primary engineered down here. It's parked up just over the horizon there in your very, very near future, waiting for you. And this is why you have your surveillance systems where they are. This is why you've got your triangulation and your techno gadgets with you. Because the idea is they need to know where you are. And for people like maybe me and people like you, if you do this in your group, the idea is they're onto it and they can disrupt it as easily as you know, even a serious rider on the back of a horse. And the horse wants to have him thrown, all he's got to do is a little twitch there and drop the shoulder, and it doesn't matter how experienced you are, you're off. And so they've actually defeated you before you've even got going. And with the type of technology that they have, and if they want to listen in, they don't have to, you know, as you're typing your email, it's coming up on an NSA screen somewhere in some place where you'd probably you'd rather not be. So, unfortunately, from that perspective, the human element of how you can overcome it is quite tragic. So it only really leaves one type of get out of jail card, and that's some type of spiritual intervention, because it isn't something that we could do, and I could equip you now with all the latest type of techno wizardry that you could think of, but it wouldn't really get us further than probably Haydock Racecourse before the bigger unit turns up. So that constant battle of force is never really going to get anyone anywhere, and that's why every revolutionary movement historically has always failed, because it's always become what it sought to defeat. So, you know, violence would beget violence, and the same tactics that you used to try and defeat it would ensure that you became the conception or the birth product of that. So humanity, I think it's just serving to show it needs a change of consciousness. And that's what will get it through, and that's the only thing that will get it through, because once people change the way they think and what they're prepared to accept, is it does put off like an energy shimmer. You know, if you're ever in front of a judge or a headmaster, they always want you there, and they look you in the eye, and are you telling the truth? And people are suckers for the truth. And if you've got truth on your side, then typically it should carry you. But if you kinesiotherapy, you know, when they show about how the lack of force in the body degrades quite drastically between when you're telling the truth and a lie.
Kinesiology.
Thank you. And so the human being, you know, the auric fields and the energetic fields or the morphogenetic fields that we live in and radiate, they all have these energy pictures to them, and we give off what we're basically believing. So this is why there's this constant bombardment to try and drag us down. And the idea is that if we are an evolutionary species, then we need to be evolving, because there's no standing still on a tightrope. And if you're not evolving, you're devolving. And that, unfortunately, is the process that the planet is in at the moment. It's in a deep, it's being forced into a devolutionary, what's called omega minus ascension cycle. So what that is doing is the overall vibrationary parameter of the planet is being pulled down. This is why you have the nuclear power stations. This is why you have the BP oil industry polluting the Amazon. This is why you're having all the endangered species endangered and wiped out and becoming extinct. This is why the oceans are being polluted and overfished. This is why it goes on. This is why the wars are there. Why the fields of Iraq, just like the fields of Flanders, are soaked in blood even now. Because the agenda for the dark side is to take it down, control it, and put it in its primal, lower vibrating, fear-based energy. Yeah? So, that's the good news. So, right, so apart from that, yeah? Apart from that, it would therefore suggest that there has to be some type of connecting answer. And this has been proved with this 100 monkey principle for people who've studied psychology within primates, or where one monkey on an island in the middle of the Sumatra Peninsula or wherever starts to crack open a particular shellfish in a particular way. And then within a few weeks, the monkeys on the other island with no connectivity whatsoever actually start to copy the same type of behavior. So we are all connected and our minds are all one. So this behavior pattern can work for the positive and it can work for the negative. It's just at the moment we seem to be, there's always that potential for becoming so disillusioned in this, what's called learned helplessness, with this constant bombardment of we can't do anything, that prevails. And so we just drift on down the line and nothing happens, and winter follows summer and Christmas comes again, and then we're another 5 years down the line and we might be doing this when the next election comes. Or we might not even be allowed to go out the house and we have to do it on the internet then. And then that is a bit of a mess. So one of the things the politicians have just been telling us in the lead up to the election time and time again is that the world is in an economic crisis, particularly since 2008. There is no money. The Greek government is driving through on these austerity measures. All of Europe is a sick man now, and the British economy did better than most. And the American economy now, we see, after pumping the Federal Reserve $30 billion a month into Wall Street, right the way through 2009 and 10 and 11 and 12 and on. And now Mario Draghi, the head of the European Central Bank, proclaiming that over the next 2 years they're going to pump $2 trillion into the European market to create the same failure that the Americans successfully did, and it didn't work. Makes you think, well, why isn't there enough money then? Where is it? So
it goes to hoarders.
It does, to those damned hoarders. So this then ties in with this situation where the vast majority of the money is owned by an almost infinitely small percentage of the population. So let's look at how we could solve it. Miliband would say it can't be solved. Farage would say, Alex Salmond would say, Cameron for sure, and his crowd. There is no exception to it. Once you become an MP, you are blooded into the hood. These are all mafia-made men. Now, look at Clegg. Nick Clegg before he went into coalition with the Conservative government before. He had some quite radical proposals. He had a very strict stance on what was going to happen with school university fees, university fees and things like that. But within a very, very short time of him becoming a coalition member with Cameron, you could see not only his demeanour, but his face changed and his expression. And he looked like someone who had his spinal column ripped from under him or from out from his back. And this is because somebody in Whitehall, these mandarins, these chiefs of power that actually call the shots, would have read him the equivalent of their riot act. Okay? So you're in, you stay in. If you want to leave, keep your mouth shut. And if you want a comfortable ride and a future for you and your family and a political career or a comfortable career, then you'll do as we say. And if not, you'll end up like they all end up from Hugo Chavez or Morales or an infinite number or the David Kellys or whoever wants to step out of line. And that's invariably no longer living. So there is an agenda, and this is what the lie is. So there's something called, in the United States, a financial transaction tax that people have tried to bring to the fore. Some people call it the Robin Hood tax, supposedly taking from the rich and giving to the poor. But the bottom line here, whatever you want to call it, it has been rumoured that one or two people would like to be able to introduce it. WeaBank and the political side of this re-movement aspect, is something that this has been nailed firmly onto the wall with as a means to not only fund re-movement, but also to try and fund a government in waiting, which would be called, like say, a government de jure or de jure instead of de facto. So the government that's presently sitting in Westminster now would be called de facto because they're sitting there ostensibly ruling it. De yes, jure, Monsignor?
De jure is legal, de facto is law.
Is what, sorry?
De facto is law.
Is law, okay. So
a misleading concepts on de jure and de facto.
Okay, right. So the government that are in Westminster now would be?
A pseudo government.
Okay, right. So we've got some semantic things to iron out there. But the bottom line therefore is, where would the money come from and how could it be raised? The amount that the HM Treasury or Revenue and Customs bring in over the course of a year is estimated roughly to be about 640 billion. Okay, so just remember that, 640 billion. The GDP for the UK, that's gross domestic product for all the goods and services, is about 3 trillion. Okay? So, when the government is saying they've got no money for the health service, it could easily be fixed with a few billion. Okay? But somebody's supposedly got to pay for that, and it's got to be you, because there's nowhere else for it to come from. When you look at all the taxes there out there, there are 385 principal ones and then stretching into thousands of others. So even your indirect taxation at the street there when you pay for your car parking, etc., is a tax. It's a non-consensual one because it's been forced on you by a statutory instrument, but there it's a tax. So let's look at what could be done. And I'll quote some figures. Let's say we abolished every single tax that there is, PAYE, council tax, free parking could be had by everyone everywhere, there would be no self-assessment tax, there'd be no capital gains tax, any other taxes that anyone could think
income
of?
Income
tax, which is a nice one, that could go. Fuel tax, there's about 87%.
Oxygen tax.
Oxygen tax, yeah, all these green taxes and that. On the cost of your litre of fuel, about 87% of that is taxed. For the cost of your food, everything you eat, the farmer is only paying 37%, but all that tractor time and pulling and harvesting, a great percentage of that is there. So you're taxed from the moment the farmer's trying to seed it from the people who are working with him, who've got to pay the council tax, on and on and on and on. So as a rough estimate, if you take any product, and I would say divide it by about a 6 or a 7, you'd have the cost of the article that it should be hitting you at. And if we say, well, 5 is easier maths, if you're getting something sold to you for 100, divide it by 5, 20 should be enough. That's the bullshit, that's the tax, that's the banking cut that you're being made to take. So let's look, if we then decided, instead of trying to tax the people some more, well, let's look at all the money that's flushing around the UK market now. This is just the UK. So this is looking at things like BACS, clearing system, CHAPS, LCH, London Clearing, something called BARX, which is Barclays dedicated transaction thing. If we then look onto, this isn't touching over-the-counter derivatives, this isn't touching London Bullion Exchange or London Metal, but it is including LIFE, London International Financial Futures, and partly the London Stock Exchange. Okay, now, in 2013, they collectively had a turnover of 1,845 trillion dollars, right? A 1% tax on that would be 1.845 trillion. 1.8, I told you that the total tax revenue for the UK was 648 billion. Well, just times 6 by 3, 3.6 is 18, so we're just about at 9 there, a threefold. So, could abolish every single tax in the UK and just tax at 1% those monies that are coming in, and you'd have 3 times the amount. So, if we look at CLS Group, 4.9 trillion a day in 2013. New York Stock Exchange LIFE, that was coming in at 474 trillion euro throughout 2013. This is just for 1 year, by the way. And just in case you think Wall Street is the big player, 37% of all international trade goes through the City of London. And it is the center of the cobweb par excellence, because it's an enclave. It's a bit like the equivalent of Monaco or Liechtenstein or Andorra. It's got its own everything. So CHAPS in 2013, 70.1 trillion went through. The BAC system, 4.2 trillion. Barclays, it's called their BARX system or platform, that handles 50 billion a day, and 7.5 trillion went through in 2013. And these figures have gone up a little bit, because by 13, they were just recovering from the situation in 2008 or 9. So when they say there is no money, there's lots. It's just that it's banks, and banks install governments, and governments tell you what to do, and governments are there to ensure that the austerity is loaded on your back and not on the backs of their friends in the banking community. So it's things like this that have got to get out. And ask yourself the question, if there's no control of this and the media's fair and balanced, why would something like this never ever be allowed, even as a question on Question Time? It wouldn't be allowed, and it may, someone might come around and say, oh well, yeah, it was asked once or whatever. But if I know it, why don't these politicians know it? Why doesn't someone like Nigel Farage become ultra unconventional all of a sudden and start to say, well, this would be quite a good proposal for us? Or why doesn't some other party mention it? So the fact of the matter is, there is more than enough. The figures are almost precise no matter what country you move in across the global platform. And where this is all then controlled from is the Bank of International Settlements in Basel, Switzerland. And that's the central clearing bank of all central clearing banks. And that was set up on the back of, well, actually it was in process before something called the Bretton Woods Agreement, 1944. It's where we get this global currency model from, when in effect all the global gold supplies were hoovered up and put into a particular sanctuary so that the rollout for the credit facility around the planet could take place. So the bottom line is there's a lot of money there and you don't have it. It's all what's called black screen, and that means there are two separate accounting systems on the planet. There is the one that you all seem like in the Matrix to live in front of, and that's the screen that when you go in and ask for the loan, the computer says no or yes. Remember Little Britain? Computer says no. And you've got this world of ATM money and what they say is there. But the money that Tony Blair inherits as his thank you after his time in office, or that Cameron will be given, and that Thatcher and Dennis Thatcher and Ted Heath, etc., get given, is facilitated in a slightly different way. Depending on how much they want him to have, then there's usually what's called a private placement platform arranged. And that's an investment project where that money might be traded overnight or it might be traded for a certain number of days. And so from behind the screen comes a substantial deposit of money into the account. So that comes from behind the screen, off account, into the bank. That is traded or then left on deposit at a certain amount of interest until the interest rate is accumulated to the amount that they want him to have. And then the capital amount is then pulled in back from behind the behind the screen, and the interest-bearing security from the global trust account. And one of the signatories and key holders for that is Bill Clinton, a Rhodes Scholar. That's how that money aspect is generated. So the capital never gets touched. The increase of the wealth comes in on this side of the counter, so it can be spent in this type of world here. So the shenanigans and the deceit and the extent to which all this is perpetrated on everybody is so far beyond a reasonable reality projection that it's like standing in front of a step and thinking it's a mountain. You know, because you think, whoa, it's just so big, because you can't actually see that it is a step. And this is why they work it so well, because this is the nature of the game, that most people can't accept that it's either so old a trick or that so many people could have fell for it in the past. And so there's the opponent and there's the victim. And you have to choose which one of those you are, but it seems that they're the opponent. And so to challenge it, you have to challenge your own common sense, your own discernment, and the fact that you've been duped. And very few people really want to go around questioning their own intelligence and belief system. So it perpetrates again. And so we in almost a flash of a mind, we ignore it, we let it go, and we let it drift. So from this point of view, it's good news, because if we know about it a little bit more and we get more and more people talking about it and realizing it, not necessarily accepting this as truth, but just start to widen the view a little bit and try and challenge some of these belief systems. So that's really just to say that this, the 1%, I actually, it was called a financial transaction tax, but I tried to change it into something called financial commercial UK transaction tax, which stands for fucked. So what I'd like them to know is They are fucked. And if I get my way, I'll fuck it up to 5%, because at 5% only, and if you don't believe it's a topic, go onto YouTube and look at the Bill Nighy video. Yeah, has anyone seen it? Great guy. We need people like this on board. You know, we want all these moneyed people to come and join with us. And there are people like Keith Allen who did Unlawful Killing. Yeah, there are people like Bill Nighy who've got a real taste for this. We've got to start getting them in. What my plan is, before the end of the year, we want these meetings in football stadiums with 60,000 in, regional. And the football owner, or whoever's in charge of the stadium, won't have a choice of whether we're coming in, because 30,000 of the 60,000 will be the same people that turn up to the match on the Saturday. You know? So we've got to get to that stage. And then we can do it, you know, we can do it regional, you know, we can do it wherever. We do it in Manchester, we do it in Liverpool, and we start bringing it together. Maybe, you know, by the end of the year, might be a bit ambitious, but I don't think we've got that much time. We can't let this roll on for another 5 years. We'll be, you know, you'll be like fish on a slab, you know, and thinking, how did that all happen? So what I'd say to you all, if you could just do me one thing, whether you believe in a God, or whether you believe in a higher consciousness, whether you believe in an over-self, or, I don't know, some type of energy, call it what you want, whatever you feel comfortable with. Sometime today, when you go home, or in a quiet moment, just either offer a little bit of it to anyone in here, or to what I want to try and do. But make sure you put it in a protective conditioning, because only if I am what I claim to be will it vest. And if I'm not, then there's a karmic consequence. And so that's the challenge to anyone that questions the integrity of what I'm trying to do. Because, It's I'm quite passionate about it. I don't wish any of these people that I talk about any harm. I'd shake Tony Blair by the hand, I'd shake Cameron by the hand, I'd shake them all by the hand. But I want to get to that point where we look them in the face and said, your time's up, step aside, we're in charge now, and we're going to do it. There's no retribution, we don't need to have trials of accountability and reconciliation. We just think, move out the way and let us get on. So if anything good has come out of what's just happened over the last couple of days, then it will be, you know, this bit of an emotional incident I've just had now. But I've got to start getting it a bit more emotional. I've got to start pushing it in people's faces a little bit more. Because if it's worth doing, it's worth doing correctly, and it's worth doing right. So I'd throw that open to everybody now, and I'll put a bit of a reminder on whatever's guiding you for your reason of being down here. the other point was, there's a bit of an anecdote by Anthony Wedgwood Benn, or Tony Benn, about how people got involved in, you know, these corridors of dark power. And when he became elected to the cabinet, he had to become a member of the Privy Council, and he refused to take the oath. But the administrator of the oath had actually said to him at the point, and he says this in one of his interviews, it doesn't matter whether you take the oath or not, and it doesn't matter whether you keep your fingers crossed behind your back. I've already administered the oath. It stands. So there's no, with the game that these politicians are in, the 650 that have just been elected to this Hammer House of Horror production, they'll all go down the road satisfied and taking their lump of money, and for an extra few hundred thousand, they'll be in the right place at the right time to put the signature on the executive order or the bill so that they can live very comfortably for the remaining 40 years or so, write a book, be fated in London, in Mansion House, but the people sold into the next tranche of surveillance, whereby I see in Sweden now they've got this dust powder which you just shake someone's hand and it goes on your hand and they can track you wherever, and it's just becoming quite nightmarish if it isn't already. So something needs to be done. I do understand the intricacies of how long this has gone on for. It does go back way beyond Rome, goes beyond Greece, it goes beyond Pharaoh Akhenaten in Egypt, it goes past Babylon, it goes past the Harians and the Hittites, it goes back to the Anunnaki referred to in the Bible. I don't know what sections where it talks about the Nephilim. So it goes way, way back. It's a very extended agenda, but I'll assure you all that you've got a ticket to be down here for a certain reason, and it isn't to be crushed and end up in some phantom fourth dimensional prison planet hovel, where if you don't do exactly what you're told to do, you know, you end up in a very, very catastrophic situation. But that's where they want to take it. You just join the dots up to see where it's going. As the Panchen Lama says, do not pay any attention to what they say at the moment. Look at the wake of the ship. What's it left in its wake? You can see it's consistent. You don't have to be a clairvoyant to see where it's going. They're taking on a very dark and dangerous agenda. And they've got help. They're very confident. But ultimately, it's all based on fear and it's based on lies. And that can be overcome. Just as light will extinguish darkness, darkness doesn't have its own principle. And just like, you know, the sun will, you know, melt a snowflake. So I think that's probably about it for now. And there's not that much more to cover, but we've covered quite extensive amount. So what I'll do now is I'll just say thank you for listening. And we'll get more passionate about it. Wherever you go, just be a defender if you believe in what I've said now, that it can be done, and I want all these groups to come together. I put the proposal to Roger Hayes some time ago. I put it to Simon Spaniard. I've put it to various other people I spoke to. I was doing this in 2012. If we don't work together, if we don't come together as a group and forget the separate identities and our road shows, it's not going to go anywhere, and it'll fail just like all these others, because this is proven here. Now, just final point. It's a good one. What you've got is me trying to do this little project. In total, it's probably brought in over the course of... It launched, the first checkbooks went out on the 17th. Do the maths, there's about 250 joined. Some have had memberships, some have taken checkbooks. There's been about 9,000 brought in. And for that, I've virtually been ripped apart. I had the bank account closed, PayPal closed, the website's down. How many bankers have been prosecuted in the, you know, since 2008?
None.
But none, if none.
Icelandic ones.
Pardon?
Just the Icelandic ones.
Yeah. So, great old Iceland, actually, because that's a good point. So, with all of this effort, you can see how little it actually achieves, you know, on the face of it. However, there's an underlying current which is bigger than all of this. Touching on the Icelandic agenda there, it's very important because 3 weeks ago, just after I launched, the first checks went out on the 17th, I think, I got in touch with a guy called Frosty Sigurdsson. Nice name for a guy from Iceland, Frosty. And he wrote a book on monetary reform, a briefing document for a guy, the president of Iceland, I think it's Olaf Grimsson. And the president of Iceland has done a very important thing. He's put the policy document, and they're promising what they're doing is kicking the private and commercial banks out of Iceland, because he states that Iceland has a long, long history of social homogeneity, no unrest, good employment, and was a very happy and carefree society until 2008, when it all went wrong. And what it entailed is that every man, woman, and child of the 324,000 around inhabitants of Iceland owed over $400,000 each. Through no fault of their own, because of the lending practices of the private Rothschild-controlled banking cartel running out of Iceland. And this is why all these public authorities had bought into the deal, and why they were all being quoted 14-15%, and Stoke-on-Trent City Council being probably as stupid as a donkey's back legs. They actually went in big time, thinking they could clear whatever debts they were suffering, but ended up in a worse situation. And so what he said is, in 2008, they were Exhibit A in the global arena of how not to behave. But he says, the democracy had to rule. The people marched on Parliament. They were threatening to burn it down. The police, instead of confronting, turned and joined with them. So they had a referendum on it, and the referendum decided that that's what they were going to do. They were reneging on the debt, and they were staying and kicking the bankers out. So the Greeks should do it. Everybody should do it. And it would work, because he says now, unemployment is down, cost of living is normalised, everything's gone back to how it probably should have done for the hundreds of years before, until these parasitic infestations, these bankers get into you. And if a parasite's in your system, you're going to have to get it out. And that's what it is. It's been on man forever. It's biblical. There's only possibly one time in the Bible when it's reported that Jesus maybe got a little bit upset or lost his temper, and that's when he overturned the tables in the temple because he wanted the money changers out. So it's got to change. It's an energy thing, and we've got to try and change it. So let's get on with it, and what we will possibly start needing to do is, as mentioned before, every time we've got a meeting, we've got to have more every time. It's got to be so we can't get in, and so we go to the next one. And then we've got to get bigger and bigger, and then the group that's meeting over in Manchester, or whoever's formulating that, we get to a stage where we're growing it. So we've got to become an organic organism and grow it out as well. And then we can all have some peace and then spend whatever we need to. But there's more than enough. We haven't even really touched on the global collateral accounts. Anybody's heard of Neil Keenan? Yeah. Maybe look at some of his work. Sometimes people say, oh, well, I'm not so sure. Karen Hudes. Yeah, I've had some interesting conversations with Karen, and she wouldn't work. You know, she didn't want to support us when I was trying to put this together. And so there's some very interesting people there that are all sniffing around and saying the same thing. That there is money, it's available, it's yours. Very finally, on that point, the promissory note, some people have said, this is just an example of some that we can create. The promissory notes are really what's your, in effect, your promise to pay. There are two amounts of currency. There's 150,000 quoted on there in sterling, or 148,000 re. Okay. Now, the re symbol is also possibly, we'll talk about that after. But we're looking at someone, say, that's earning £20,000 a year as a normal, as a working individual, whether he's a tradesman or whether he's working in a council office, it doesn't matter. That £20,000 a year that he's earning over 10,000 years would amount to £200,000 easily, an amount sufficient to pay down the promissory note. So what we've done is we've changed the train tracks on the concept of who you're working for. So if you would say, for example, and I used the analogy earlier, you're working for an agency, you go and work for the council to do whatever they're having you do. The council are paying you seven, or the agency's paying you £7 an hour. The agency's getting 14 an hour. So you're actually getting, someone's getting paid 14 an hour for you. So what we've done is we've adjusted the incident and the calibration and the relationship between a bank that you have pledged a promise to and the way you pay that down. And there's two different tracks, therefore. There's the ability to pay it down in re, by going out and doing any type of work, anywhere you choose, whatever you might define as work. Whether it's polishing your shoes, driving your kids down, to driving someone to the airport, putting cupboards up, cutting the grass, it's all got to be done, and it's work. And it's work, it's value, and if you don't do it, someone else would have to. And if you're wealthy enough, you'd have someone to come in and cut the grass at the weekend. You wouldn't do it yourself, or prune your own trees, just because you're poor. That's why you do it. So not only can you pay it down with the re-units, but we'll allow you then to credit your actual working energy to paying down the promissory note and keeping the money. We don't want the money. You keep it, but we'll credit it against, because we say you should be earning more. And if anyone wants to put their hand up and think, say, yeah, no, I think I'm actually getting paid what I'm worth, then, you know, maybe go and join someone else, because, you know, we want to be more kind with you. What we can also look at for people who are a little bit aged and wanting to come in, they look at the scenario, well, there's no way I'll ever be able to pay it down. I like the idea of this promissory note thing, but I don't quite understand it, but I'm 75, there's no way I can pay it down. Well, how long have you been working before you retired? Okay, 25, 35 years. Do you think you were paid what you were worth? Maybe, no, and yeah, and all this time, and I was made unemployed and all of this. Right, well, let's look at the historical perspective. And let's go back then and say, well, look, if there's any precedent for this. Miss Soul PPI, repatriation after the First World War that the Germans had to pay, the Treaty of Versailles, the supposed readjustment for injustices of the past, where you should have been paid. Look at the Nazi concentration, the Jewish Nazi concentration victims, where they eventually took on not so much the German government for actual payments, but the Swiss banks. So it does have a precedent, and it does have an accepted quantifiable structure. So why don't we look a little bit back and say, well, we actually think you should have been earning a lot more. And we don't have to stop there. We can also go, well, what about what your parents should have been earning? And look at all the people who died in, you know, in poverty and hunger and didn't have enough to eat or couldn't put, you know, electric on, etc. So there's a social aspect to it that says, if you're the last electrons on the head of the needle now, then the planetary inheritance is yours. You know, and the same to be said for the people in Indonesia and in South America and wherever they are. That's it. Everything that's ever been created is your inheritance, and it's there now. And look how much you've got of it. You know, be lucky if we all tipped each other on our bloody heads now, we could put £1,000 together in the room. So it's not right. So, but apart from that, I don't really have much of an opinion on anything. You know, so don't quote me on any of this.
Peter, the turning back for Iceland was when the police turned round and supported the people. That was the turning
point. Yeah.
How do we, I mean, with all this G4S that's coming through and all these Mossad trained new officers that's been coming through the ranks, how do we get the police on our side? Because it is all about education, isn't it?
Yeah.
We've got the army as well. If we could get the army and the police to educate it to what all this is about, they might turn.
Well, it's a very good question, and it's not one I don't have a ready answer to it. I think the only way it will probably come is either we get to sufficient numbers. That's always a consideration, and then that's probably the only way I could think of. Otherwise, yeah, it's a very good question, because if I thought there was an easier way through it, I would do it. And yes.
I was just going to say, I had a conversation with somebody last year who was in ex-military, and he was telling me that there is some people somewhere, and I led to believe it was Australia, that was gathering a behind-the-scenes military together with all these arrest warrants.
Yeah.
And in January, they were going to go out and just go around and just arresting all these people.
Yeah.
And I thought, well, that's a bit far-fetched, isn't it? Sounds like a movie. And obviously nothing happened. But he was telling me that there are so many people trapped inside these systems.
Yeah.
And they all want out.
Yeah.
And they can't get out.
Okay, well, so that's, if we could just address that point. I would say there's probably about 300 reasonably old men and women running the show. And so we're all, in effect, being told what to do, how to eat, what to drink, from a series of cascading system of orders. It's almost like whatever would radiate out from a web. And all these areas are quite mutually independent. And people say, oh, people can't keep secrets. Well, these can keep secrets very well. We put together in this room here within, and we had to decide what the colour of the walls are and the ceiling. There'd be fighting, and half of them would run out. The women would all go and make tea, and we'd all decide by 10 o'clock tonight it was irreconcilable and it couldn't be done. Yeah? There'd be half of you wouldn't speak to each other again, and we'd all be pissed off saying, it's just typical, isn't it? So how do they do it? You've got people like Condoleezza Rice, you've got people like Schwarzkopf, you've got people like, I don't know, and over here in our crowd, you know, I can't name them. They're up at 5 o'clock, they're in the gym by 6, they've had breakfast and they're in their office before most guys are getting out of bed and having a pee. You know, they're dedicated and they're within a very rigid, hierarchically crystallized system, and you don't mess around with it or step out of line, and therefore you know where you're going. And it's a typical tyrannical, reptilian, dominant, bigger is better, prison planet, king of the hill structure. You don't answer back, you get it done. And if you get a phone call from somebody higher up in the profile, then you do as you're told. Otherwise, you might get another go at it, but then you probably won't. Because that's what they want, a blind, subservient obedience to the ritual. And it's the fundamental initiation platform in all Masonic ritual. They have their third degree invariably is entirely concerned with raising the dead. Raising you from a casket.
Dead shall rise and the meek shall inherit the earth.
Yeah, sure, hopefully he got that right, because if he didn't, then we're all a little bit waiting for the next cattle car. So, I'm a great believer, you know, as it says in the Bible, if somebody strikes you on the left cheek, then turn the other. But he didn't really say what you did after that one. Yeah? You don't be a bit of an idiot and start becoming a masochist and getting your head whipped off your head. So Jesus came down to do a very, very, if you believe in the character, or whether it's Jeshua or whatever you want to term him as, if the character existed, he came down for a very, very specific training exercise.
I heard it was a Yamaha.
Okay, a Yamaha. So he came down with a very specific task. To show you that the body didn't mean anything and that you were a spiritual being having an earthly experience in a monkey suit. And that's why everything that was ultimately thrown at him at the end was the culmination of the workshop. He was abandoned, he was betrayed, he was beaten, he was nailed up, his followers turned their backs on him. Every single thing you could think of, where we're looked at just slightly like that at 9 o'clock by the girl in the Greg's pie shop and it's ruined our day, he tried to basically show none of it matters. Yeah? It's just about forgiveness. But it was a specific methodology because of the chakra and the ray that he was operating on. And it was fourth heart, unconditional love, where you fall in love even with your jailer or the man that's nailing you to the cross. because you see the infinite compassion and wisdom in it. But the wisdom isn't so good there if you want to maintain a teaching ministry for another 30 years. Because that's the next one up, fifth, which is the blue chakra, which is something to do with blending unconditional love with wisdom. Right? So he was down for a very specific mission. So when people start, you know, we've got to make sure that, you know, it all evolves here, because we don't want to get locked into a 2,000-year-old mindset that was written 600 years after the characters had all disappeared off the stage. So lots to talk about. That's good. Thank you. We're going to do some questions now. A few more questions, did we say? So thank you. Right, yeah, anyone?
The way our band now. I joined last week after meeting you in
So it's a very good question. The question is, how do we join Weir Bank now? Hopefully the website will be back online early this week, and we'll find out for sure why it went off. And so for now, what I propose is that people will wait for the website to come back online, and then PayPal's not going to be an option. The banking system can't be an option. And so in a way, there's some type of reverse irony there. And we might be say we give them a round of applause, because if we're setting up to do what we're proposing to do and still relying on them to play ball with us, then yeah, I think I could say I was being like triple naive. So what we will have to move is to an alternative payment system somehow, or it'll have to be done by meetings with collections, like it was done in the old day, like when the rent man used to come around knocking on your door every second Friday, and you used to hide behind the curtains and pretend you weren't in. I don't want to go through anything usually on regulated on the internet, because I find I believe truly that it's the work of the devil himself. It's flat pack IKEA, extraterrestrial technology delivered to Bill Gates and his gang to furnish the agenda. And there was a halcyon or a golden period that you pass through when everything looked like, hey, I can find out anything. But now you can find out nothing. And within 30 seconds, if you're going to look for something, you can't even remember what the question was that you were looking for in the first place. So I think it's set up to do its job very well. And it also eradicates the domain of the wise person that you would turn to for advice. Now, you say something, everybody goes on the internet and goes, I heard it's blue. Or it isn't like that at all, I've been told. And this is why you have this bias within the journalism on the pretense that they're giving fair and unbiased reporting. No one wants fair and unbiased reporting in any type of teaching that they're ever given. They want the teacher to tell them how it is. Not, well, we've been told that if you walk down there, you can go there, and we've been told here. So at the end, the person's gone, yeah, but what's right? So it fractionates your mindset straight the way down, and you don't know. That's why people don't know anymore. They have no idea whether it's left, right, or up and down. So just to finish off on that, it'll either be an alternative, or we are looking now to move it to the next level. With anybody seen the Love Guru, Mike Myers, Toronto Maple Leafs, someone out there. What he does is initially he tells the guy he's trying to cure, under no conditions sign these things without having produced a promissory note and having the checkbook, but we may look to up it where we make it available as a PDF and we have everybody sign everything for anything. So we basically people empower it even more. Because the only thing that's the restriction is where the funds come from. And touching on what June said before about the so-called theories of who's going to be arrested and will it ever come a day of accounting, there are for sure very powerful groups of individuals out there who are just waiting in the background to move on these things. and it's all like, who's gonna try and go for the king first? And when that happens, yeah. So what this is in part done is to stimulate a global discussion on it, because whether you realise it or not, it's gone reasonably global. The checkbooks have gone out everywhere. People are passing them in California as much as in Ontario. People are passing these checks out over here. All the banking communities say, what are they? What shall we do with them? They can ignore them and put them anywhere, but they're still there. It hasn't gone away. And as long as it's still got the presence, then we need to then take it onto this next level where we start to say, right, this is the agenda, because it's not thought out. There's a lot of dimensional activity going on with it as well. So there's the, where's the wealth come from? First start with the people. Let the people come in and create their own keys and see if they'll open the door for themselves. Once you've actually knocked on the window, it lets the higher authority come in and say, hey, they're actually trying to help themselves for the first time in God knows how long. We'll now come in and aid even more. So why don't we now, you know, we'll ease up. We'll put WD-40 on the stuff that would never move. And we'll, because there's no rescue mission. There's no ETs going to come unless it's done with holographic insert technology wrapped into your perceptual reality fields. You're going to have to do it yourself. And the reason you have to do it yourself, because if you got rescued, you could always call foul or throw down the flag and go, yeah, but I know it was bad, but I didn't really intend for you to come and rescue me. You ruined my game. So the nature of the soul is that you've come down here to experience. If you're all part of unity, which you have to be, then you must be part of God. Therefore, you must be God. There's no separation. There's unity consciousness. Everything has to come from somewhere. So whether we all end up as a ball of whatever, it's one ball. It's not 500 of them. So that's the key, and that's where it's got to go back to. And as long as there's consciousness infiltrating and what's called universally passing through, then there's all these sages and wise people say that if you're on, whether you're on peyote buttons or whatever, you start to see the real nature of the energy of the chairs and the wood and the ceiling, and it's just photonic energy.
What about a post office bank account?
Post office bank account, everything gets cleared through NatWest.
Is it?
Yeah. So what we're up against is UK clearing, and they control the ring. And it's just like a series, just like the same family sitting down at night around the tea table. One's a second-hand car dealer, one sells on the market, one does something else, one does this. And they're all sitting around, how did you do today? Oh, I lost 400 quid. How did you do? Yeah, I made 2,500 on that. How you? Yeah, okay. And the head of the banking family, family at the end of the day goes, okay, fine. They all get up and walk away. They don't all settle up with each other because it's all the same cartel. It all stays in the house. It's one family. So they're not doing set-offs. They're not saying, oh, unless it gets to ridiculous amounts where one bank's going of it and then they'll transfer cash. So we will look into it. We'll find a way. What my dream would be is we just start hitting all the checks with re on it. So instead of when the mortgage is saying it's 143,000 sterling to pay off the mortgage, you don't send them sterling. We send them our current unit of account. And then we've done two things, because you've got to look at the fact, well, who actually owns sterling, you know, the symbol. Just for people out there, these symbols, the pound with the two lines through, the yen, two lines through, euro, two lines through, dollar, two lines through. Who lives next door to number 10? Number 11, double entry bookkeeping. Called Zionist Kabbalistic Numerology, Solomonic Numerology. Double male energy, twin towers. So just trust me on that. So Solomonic Kabbalistic Numerology is what the double entry bookkeeping system is involved, and why you've got the 8/8 as a trust bank account on the checks. Is 8/8 to 64, 64 squares on a checkboard, 64 square acres in a square mile, City of London, square mile, Washington, DC area, 10 times that area, 64 codons within human DNA. So there's a lot of thought and stuff gone into this, and it's big, except it doesn't sometimes see it. It looks like, if you listen to the people on the internet, some scam artist trying to get 10 quid off people, that if he then turns up, they're not going to kill him. Doesn't, you know, nothing stacks up yet, you know, it's just a nonsense. So whatever the question was, that might
have... We're receiving the payments, how are we doing payments?
Yeah, so for now, it was never about money, apart from it is about money. It's not about me making money, yeah? I live very frugally. I've got borrowed shoes, and I always say the same thing, so excuse me. I don't have major overheads. I don't have my own car. I don't have my own house. I don't have my own bank account now. Not that there was much in. There's not a desire for me to aggrandize myself. I don't want a big block of offices, and I don't need a fancy car, and you know, I've got no family. So I'm in a perfectly suited position to try and accompany what has to be done without overdue pressure being put on extensions of what we might call ourselves to be. So how we actually do it from here on
just
in.
One point I just wanted to
yeah, sorry, fella.
So what I'm understanding is the spanner in the works at the minute is that people can't get the payments to you to pay for checkbooks they want.
Yeah, I'll just very quick answer that. The question was that the spanner in the works is the fact that people can't get payments to us or to me.
Postal orders.
Yeah, maybe. It's a very good point. And also, initially, I was quite happy to go with the idea that people should know each other before they came in. But I saw that that was going to take forever. So eventually, I made a sort of just a decision that it was better for the message to go out now and for it to go out sometimes by the people who might have been writing checks irresponsibly than to wait, because we could sit here for a whole day and go through it, and certain people would still make mistakes at the end. And some of the biggest mistakes, just so I can mention why some of these things have gone wrong or not cleared, are the mistakes that the people have made themselves. Yeah? Classic trick that's being pulled by the banks is, well, if you want to pay off your mortgage, they're telling you to make it payable to yourself. Which beggars the question, if the bank who lent you the money say to close your mortgage account off, you should make the cheque payable out to you, who did you borrow the money from in the first place in order to do that? The other one is, they're doing things like, the council say, don't pay us, pay post office counters. But who's going to take you to court for non-payment? It's not post office counters. They're also then making the mistake of not stapling a launch to the cheque or accompanying one with it. They're making the mistake of signing the cheque on the back themselves. So they're endorsing their own cheque, which you shouldn't do. So some of the shots in the foot have been self-inflicted. But apart from that, it served its purpose, and it may be, and it's a very good question and a solution that this chap's just suggested, it may be that, you know, the checkbook stage now, it's not over, but we've got to know, I've just got to assess how it's going to go from here, because it's like everything, there's the people outside that, you know, like the fuel station needs paying for the petrol, or the rail ticket won't accept and the people who produce paper or buy the paper, they won't accept. Yep. So this is the reason, and it's so not so much a contradiction, why people say, well, why don't we just take units of re? Why don't we just accept that? It's because we've got to have an outreach facility to the people beyond where we are, you know? So the printers and the post office, I mean, you know, they won't accept my check for the postal bill, and the printers don't accept it for that. So that's the only reason that we need the sterling to come in until a point where we can get enough exposure, and then we can just pull it in. But for now, it serves perfectly. It's a perfectly good point that we maybe need to do that, because meetings are the key. Not over the internet, because we're being killed by this virtual thing whereby we tick the button for the Avaz petition, or we tick a like, and we actually feel, and we're being encouraged to feel, now we've done enough. We made a contribution. Everything that's ever been changed in society requires the shoes and the people hitting the street and making their presence felt. And why a million could nearly go marching in London against the Iraq war and it made no difference proves their arrogance and the fact that there is no democracy. You're in an elected dictatorship, which we just stepped in again now for another 5 years for them to do whatever they want, and at the end of it the same discussions will go round and round. It's like a cow with BSE, you know. It's just going, it wants just putting out of its misery. It's the biggest con ever foisted on people that democracy is a viable proposition. It's a viable proposition until you get to over a certain number of people. And that extent is the number of people who can really communicate with each other within a reasonable geographically defined area. Because extend it off planet and have democracy here then translated on other planets, it can't possibly work. So you ban the colour blue down here because you just don't like it, and all those beings up on these other planets within the Confederation, they love blue. You know, they're blue. They're actually blue.
I was going to say, because the ash to meet me here, I mean, we'll sort of know each other. This would be a really good way we could be collecting the money and distributing the checkbooks from here, because we know each other.
Yeah.
Personally.
Yeah. So The only consideration then is now, just after I've got my breath, because I've had I give myself a cold and I have stress, and I've tried everything to combat it, but that's what I do. I'm very good at it. I've got it down to a fine art. It always starts the same and ends the same. So when I've got this next few days sorted out, we'll see how it's going. I think I might be moving from where I am, and by the time this goes out, then I'll probably have already moved. That's because of the place I'm living. I can't really expose. These are normal people, you know. I mean, they wouldn't come to a meeting like this. They're very good, salt of the earth, normal people. So it gets to a point where you feel, whether it's a psychological paranoia, or whether it's all of it's psychological, or whether it's genuine, that, you know, it may be time to just not be putting so much pressure on. Also, the conditions, just for the record, there's no one else behind the scenes doing this. There's just me. It's me that answers the phone, me that stuffs the envelopes, me that writes them, me stands in the queue at the post office. Me that then answers the phone to PayPal to try and find out where the tracking code is. It's me that answers the emails on the computer, etc., etc. So I think we've done quite, we've done quite well with one person. It's because I had a desire and a determination, and for whatever reason, it just looks like it was meant to happen. And we now, let's just look at it. If it hadn't have been taken offline for a moment, getting to 25 to 35 people a day and up, all consistently making the same mistake. It's quite phenomenal. So it proves there's an appetite. It proves it's right. Whether it's £10 to join or one really wouldn't matter. The idea behind the 10 is to bring in a structured organisation which restores, for the moment, the integrity and the mental recognition of the individual that his work energy is all that counts. Don't go to the bank for an extra loan. If necessary, withdraw your energy from the workplace. So it's like a workers' cooperative or a reunion. Call it what you want.
Are you aware the word dignity, as your definition, is human value? That's why it's used that word.
Yeah. So that's what we're trying to present to people, to show that you are it. It's you that keeps the wheels on the clown car. You deliver their pizzas, you drive the taxis, you teach their children, you drive their ambulances, you look after them in the hospitals. It's just you, and so few of them. So it's got to, we've got to start proving that, we've got an entitlement.
I'd just like to ask you one thing. This gentleman put forward a very valid point about the system of Amway, which is a multi-level marketing system. It would work so well for what you're trying to achieve.
Yeah.
However, you said something to me earlier, I won't say what you said to me earlier, but what you said to me earlier was, you need to be able to find key people, key groups that you can work with, and let them do it.
Yeah.
Because right now, you're a one-man entity trying to wear all the hats.
Yeah.
Now, this is why you keep getting poorly. So you're going to have to just let go a bit.
Poorly. I like that.
As we say.
No, I like that. That's what we say.
So you really need to just maybe step out of your
delegation.
Your zone.
Yeah.
And learn to delegate a bit. But it will have to be...
Okay. All raise your right hand. You're all sworn in. because... And this is the ultimate deflator of all the people that criticize this. If you look at the master PDF, and if you look at the small PDF that used to be there available on the screen, and will be again soon, the whole idea about this is everybody sets them up locally and then regionally. So, and the biggest, and here's the ultimate thing. No matter what we do with it, if we get it right and it's already must be right at the conception, because you have to visualize the conception before you get to the conception and the birth. So it was all done when it was done. And the idea is that we don't need any security on it. The biggest, what do you call it? The biggest sort of like when, compliment that anybody could pay to us is if they start trying to copy the stuff and forge, say, the checks.
Well, it's got to be said, Peter,
without joining, because...
Yeah, you've got a really solid team here, right?
Yeah.
We know most of the human races, but we all know each other, right? I can't think of a better place to use as a route for this, to show everybody this is how we can do it.
Yeah.
We work
absolutely.
As a team.
And so what I mean by that is, I mean, not people in the group, I mean, people outside. Because that proves then they want into the system. And what you've got to remember here, the one thing that we've got here is infinite supply. Think of it as God's bank, not Bank Ambrosiano or like Calvi under the Blackfriars Bridge.
I can't, that's them, sorry.
So we have infinite supply. And we have infinite supply because of the mechanism of the reunit based on a 8,766th of a mean solar tropical year, which is 1 hour of time. Wherever you are in the planet, if you're in one of the favelas and you're a small kid in danger of not eating, or whether you're in London or South Africa or Jamaica, your 1 hour of time earns you equivalent. Therefore, and we have no inflation on it, you don't have to worry about taxation on it, and you live it and you earn it. And therefore, there's a finite amount available in the day, and that's all you need. So you don't need to be trying to do, 60-hour weeks. You're just doing so many hours.
So can we?
Can we
start as a focus point?
Absolutely, and that's probably the greatest thing and the best news that's come out of today.
How many people have been interested in getting involved in this and organising?
Yeah.
Almost. Say, there's
almost everybody. So what I'll do is I will liaise with you,
Okay.
And then, you know, we will...
On a Wednesday we have a meeting, so we can...
Yeah, and then I can, and then we can start, and then like a Saturn V, we've done the first stage burn, now we're going on to the next stage, and on and on. And as long as I'm still out here, and as long as I'm still walking around doing it, we'll know it's still working. And if any of these gentlemen from out wherever want to come and talk to me about why it can't work, you've got to remember that if they want to strip it down and say it's fraudulent, if they want to say it's a criminal activity of obtaining pecuniary advantage, but whatever they want to say it is, then they have to dismantle in the courtroom the banking system's argument from the bills of exchange at the top, what's the nature of money, right the way down to the fact that people have voluntarily contributed their promissory note in full awareness of, and the fact it's not demandable, it's not payable on demand as the banking instruments are, etc. And so they have to demolish their own arguments. It still doesn't stop tyranny and whatever they want to kick the front doors in of us and do all this other stuff. But as far as a normalcy is concerned,
I've been
doing for the last 12 years is living virtually in isolation. I really haven't had anything about me or anyone to react with. And why that's happened, I don't know. Whether it's an under the radar thing, whether it's sort of they didn't see it coming thing, I don't know. But this is the first time that apart from myself and my girlfriend for five years standing now, that I started to meet and talk with people. I tried and tried and tried, but it's never happened. It's never happened. I went down to Glastonbury in 2012-13, spoke to quite an extensive group there. I put up a proposition, a proposition there to put something called a Glastonbury buffer zone together. So it was declaring Glastonbury an enclave and setting up the currency and the bank there, closing the Masonic Lodge in Glastonbury, standing down the police and the local council, and basically turning the whole environment into a self-regulatory, autonomous zone. They didn't go for it, maybe it was a bit too far-reaching. But the problem, so whatever's come out of now has come out of now through either need or force. But one of the points I'm making to you there, because when you started your discussion, what I thought you were going to do is make the point of I'm asking you to do something with the check to expose yourself to potentially prejudicial action. Okay. Now, what I did as of last week, because I wanted to protect people and I thought this was a very good idea, several of the banks have returned the checks to the individual saying either they're fraudulent or they've presented them for a clearing and they've been refused. And that's about it, really. So what I've said to the people who've had that done to them is the following. It's an old trick from the 1700s in tort law. So they then, though they've sent them the allonge, they write then to that individual or speak to them on the phone and tell them or ask them to do the following. Let's say her name is Nancy at Barclays. Hi Nancy, you told me that this had happened with Weir Bank and they'd refused to clear the cheque. Can you just, for my benefit, because I'm considering bringing legal action, you write down for me the day that you phoned, and if you can remember, either the person you spoke to, whether it was a man or a woman, or if you can't, and what was said. Because that person who signed the cheque is going to bring a criminal prosecution against me for refusing clearance. So what they've got to do now, under full commercial liability, under penalty of perjury, show, beyond reasonable doubt, in a court of law, that they presented that cheque to us for clearing, and we turned it down. And I think that's quite a good ruse, because it puts them on the back foot, and they've then got to start logging that down and showing that they are presenting them for clearing. And in 90% of the cases, they're not. They're phoning, the phone's going dead, or then they're phoning back 15 minutes later and saying, we've got this, what should we do? But the vast majority are holding on to them, and for all I know, they're what's called twinning a stream of revenue now. They're cashing them out. But the one thing you can say for sure, that they cannot come back to you on a defensive footing on that bill that has now been paid. And if they haven't submitted it to us, then that's the end. And just so that you know, the notorial protest, why it's necessary to do that, it's like playing with your mate in a game of tennis on the tennis court. And you're just having a good game, but you don't know whether you're serious or not. And he hits the ball long, but you don't call it out. And you hit it back, and then when he wins the point, you said, oh, it was out 5 ago, I'll let it run. Oh, well, you know, you should have called it, and you didn't, so the game of tennis continues. So if you don't make that notorial protest, it doesn't sort of quarterize the bleeding on the
yeah.
How many people here have had checks returned? Oh, what did yours say, fella?
Invalid.
Right. Is the check with it?
Yeah.
Okay. And is there anything written on the check?
No.
Okay. And it's not signed on the back?
No.
Okay. So invalid. Right. So what invalid means?
Invalid.
Yeah, but what they mean probably in just their part or in their discussion, the sort code isn't recognised. Okay, so what happens with that check? Who was it payable to?
British Gas.
So it goes to British Gas. British Gas, their clearing account, let's say, is with Barclays. It goes off to Barclays. Barclays are already now probably looking at it and going, right, okay, yeah, we've seen some of these. But let's say it was the first week and they hadn't seen them. They'd send that up to UK Clearing. It goes just like the letters in the post office. Goes through these machines. And it flag it and kick it out because the sort code isn't recognised. Right, but that doesn't matter because their responsibility is to find the bank on which it's drawn. Yeah? So you drew the check, the drawer, Weir Bank is the drawee, and who you've given the check to, who was it again?
British Gas
is the payee, right? So it's the obligation now of the clearing bank to find out where's the money. It says where the money is, it says Weir Bank, and there's an address, and there's even a phone number. So the phone number is there to comply with this deregulation of the Bills of Exchange Act, or they can send it, which maybe they don't want to do, but there are other means. So we're still in honour because they have just kicked it back to you, and I assure you, if they'd have got in touch and spoken, we would have said, it's cleared. So they're only kicking it out. What invalid means is, could be anything invalid, just say you hadn't put a signature on. Then you send it back with the signature on, and it still comes back invalid. And you think, well, hang on, I've just done that. So invalid means a whole different number of things. When they send them back from Virgin Media, which they have, there's about 5 different or 7 different boxes. Check not signed, check outdated, invalid sort code, all various different things that they can then tick. So did you send that protest?
They only got it yesterday.
All right. So just do that notarial protest, that will be it. If you want, you could send the check back to them on the basis that you have spoken to the bank, and they say that they haven't presented it for clearing. There'll be a fax number available by Tuesday morning, so they can just fax them in. Okay. Yes, gentlemen.
How long can they keep it in clearing? There's a 6-day rule.
Yeah, if you look at, there was a small video on the site. There's a 2-day, there's a 4, there's a 6, and after 6, The funds are in the account, and by the sixth day, the money can't be taken back out of the account.
Right.
So 10 days, everything is free, it says, and the money is yours to keep. But equally, if you go on YouTube and type in...
I've looked at that and I've done a little bit of research on their own banking rules.
Yeah.
And it appears, even if, you know, that after 6...
See you, bye-bye.
After 6 days, then that's it, isn't it?
Yeah.
Are they just keeping them in... How long can they keep it in limbo? I mean...
Well, theoretically, as it's their game, they can do whatever they want, and we're not saying different. But what we've done this for is primarily for these instances where now people are then going to be taken to court for non-payment. The whole idea of this was always the last resort. That's how it started out. The people who were just about to be evicted. The people who were just about to be repossessed.
So it stops it.
The people who were just about to have their car towed. The people who were just about to be sent to jail almost for non-payment of council tax. The people who were going to be made bankrupt by HMRC. You know, because like, when can that ever be good business? Putting someone out of business for tax when he's got a business. So there were always these last resort measures. Unfortunately, and it was always suspected it could happen, people could be a little bit hair trigger and use it beforehand, and there's no problem with that, but you know, we always wanted it so that it ends up in an arena, and the arenas then have to be the courts, they have to be in front of the bailiff, people have to be able to show and prove, look, I paid it.
Yeah.
And then they say, oh well, no, that bounced or something, but it didn't. And then we've got sufficient paperwork now out there to be able to show that sufficient had cleared and gone beyond are they just clearing them or not? Well, they're either clearing through a central place and getting through, or there's an interim level of clearing where, say, the county council can look at it and think, and they don't have to send it up to UK clearing. So how have some of these council tax bills been adjusted to zero? How can Emily Davis's American Express have gone from 6683 down to zero, and it's still stuck at zero? They haven't readjusted it. Some have readjusted it, it seems, but you know, it asks what's going on, and ultimately the question is going to be in the court of law, if it ever gets to these stages, which I'm sure it may, that these are the rules. And yeah, okay, so that's about it. Thank you very much, and till next time.